This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, drop kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short-range jumper.
Edging out in late for the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls. It has been an epicenter for basketball over the last few weeks. Today, the high school tournament takes center stage. The boys Class AA tournament will be right here on SDPB3. Along with JJ Hardigan, I'm Steve Toon. Hive of activity here in the Sioux Falls area, actually all over the state. The girls tournament last weekend, boys tournament here. JJ, there's been also college basketball going on. If you like basketball, this is your time of year.
Absolutely, yes. Basketball in South Dakota in March. There's nothing better. We wrap up a wild start to March Madness with one of the most open fields in South Dakota boys AA history that I can personally remember. Any one of these eight teams could win this whole tournament, but the next 3 days will decide how it plays out. Here's how our quarterfinal matchups are going to go in the first two games in our afternoon session, Steve. We've got number one Mitchell taking on number eight Sioux Falls Jefferson. That Jefferson team went deep into the tournament last year, came short of their championship hopes. They, as the eighth seed this year, kind of have that underdog tag on them now, and they're hoping that they can elevate to championship status. That 4-5 matchup coming up later on this afternoon is going to be a dandy, though. Two Sioux Falls teams ready to duke it out. It sets for an electric atmosphere here on day one.
Absolutely. Looking forward to it. We move on to the night session. We'll start at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. Harrisburg taking on Watertown. First time in 9 years for the Arrows at the boys basketball tournament. And we wrap up tonight with Huron taking Brandon Valley. There will be a lot of emotion in that game tonight, of course. News coming down yesterday that longtime Brandon Valley coach Brent Deckard passed away, and there will be tributes to him throughout the weekend here in Sioux Falls. Here's the brackets as we advance into semifinal Friday and then the championships Saturday night. Of course, all the games broadcast here on SDPB3 and online, sdpb.org. And welcome to you, wherever you may be watching us from around the world online. Let's meet the Jefferson Cavaliers. They are the new kids on the block. They've been to the state tournament a couple of times preceding this tournament. They were third place last year. They lost a lot of talent on that team, but Tim Reck has managed to guide this team back to the state tournament. They are 12-9 coming into today. You see, they have wins over Brandon Valley and Roosevelt and Watertown during the regular season. They beat Stevens in an overtime game to get to here, to this tournament. They beat them in the SODAC 16 round, and that sets up, JJ, this first round matchup against Mitchell. Here's their starting lineup.
This is a very good defensive group, maybe lacking just a little bit in size as far as this tournament goes. The one player we'll note is Demarius Fields. Of course, his size 5'6", but he plays above the rim at times. He plays like one of those guys who has something inside of him that he is pushing out there on the floor. The junior, one of two juniors with this group, but three more seniors that they are riding out there today. Bohannon, Sexer, very nice in the scoring options. They are going to be players that we keep an eye on throughout the tournament here as well.
Yeah, Sexer, their leading scorer at 12 points per game. So Jefferson, they're the new school in town, and they get to match up against perhaps the most storied program in boys basketball at the big school level in South Dakota, the Mitchell Colonels. Riker Kreitzfeld, he is their head coach. This is a young squad. They finished runner-up to Yankton last year. Yankton didn't qualify for the state tournament, so there will be new champions this year. And this is a team that, despite their youth, they're bringing a lot of experience back. They have wins over Jefferson, Roosevelt, and Brandon Valley. And then they knocked off the team that beat them in the state championship game last year, Yankton. That's their SODAC 16 victory that sets up their matchup for today. The Colonels 20-1 tally. Soka along with Hinker and Smith. That's your starting lineup for the Mitchell Colonels. They average 61.5 points per game, 58.7 for Jefferson, 16 titles for Mitchell over the year. We're going to send things over to Greg Thompson. He's doing our public address announcing duties for today. Let's get this thing started on SDPB 3.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association, along with its corporate partners, Sanford Health, Dakota Bank, Farmers Union Insurance, Billion Automotive, Agtegra Cooperative, ABC Rentals, The Furniture Mart, South Dakota Highway Patrol, Lake Area Tech, Mesaba, Experience Sioux Falls, and the South Dakota Army National Guard welcome you to this opening session of the State Boys AA High School Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you will enjoy the games and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please stand as we honor the flag of our great country with the playing of our national anthem. We remind all in attendance that the proper respect is to remove your hat, face the flag, stand at attention, and put your right hand over your heart. Veterans in active duty, not in uniform, may salute the flag. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. And now, let's meet the cheerleaders for both teams. We'll start with the Cavaliers of Jefferson. Macy Adams. Matilda Alex. Ava Carlson. Jaden Jessen. Jordan Jessen. Addison Riley. And Malia Splinder. Coaches Mackenzie Jensen, Katie Kruger, and Laura Weiss. Now let's meet the cheer team for the Colonels of Mitchell. Kiana Thomas. Chloe Kirkable. Jada Stoons. Kaden Christensen. Kaylin Welnitz. And Alestix Dietrich. Coach is Caitlin Clement. And now let's meet the starting lineups in alternating fashion. For the Cavaliers, at guard, 5'6" junior number 2, Demarius Field. For the Colonels, at guard, 5'11" junior number 3, Landon Sulik. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 6'1 senior, number 4, Tyler Bohannon. For the Colonels, at guard, a 6'1 junior, number 4, Marcus Talley. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 6'1 senior, number 32, Dawson Sexer. For the Colonels, at forward, a 6'5 sophomore, number 5, Colton Smith. For the Cavaliers, at guard, a 6'2", senior, number 34, Braylon Bear. For the Colonels, at guard, a 6'3", senior, number 12, Gavin Suka. And for the Cavaliers, at forward, a 6'4", junior, number 15, Mason Payne. And for the Colonels, at forward, a 6'4", junior, number 40, Gavin Hinker. The Cavaliers are led by Tim Reck. Assistant coaches Tanner Hillbrand, Jalen Smaza, Josh Thomas, Tanner Romchick, and Blake Barcher. The Colonels are led by Riker Kreitzfeld. Assistant coaches Pat Moeller, Pat Larson, Travis Salmonson, and Matt Hendrickson. Your officials for this game, Jeff Schroeder, Andrew Gross, and D'Amico Rodriguez.
Along with J.J. Hardigan, I'm Stan Toon. Great to have you here. Mitchell, the number one team in the state in the final poll. Jefferson unranked. These teams met in the middle of the season. Mitchell won 71-58. The tip controlled by the Colonels. Bohannon will run the show. Zone defense right away for Jefferson.
It'll be interesting to see what type of tone this defense brings out for Jefferson. During their recent six-game winning streak, they've been holding opponents regularly right around 45 points a game. They are playing great defense at the right time, but have a real challenge today in front of them with the Colonels.
Smith traveled, turnover for the Colonels. So you get a look at the coaching staff there for Jefferson, and we will note the coaching staffs all wearing specialty shirts today to honor Coach Deckert. We'll talk about that more as the afternoon progresses.
Jefferson's key offensively, with maybe their size disadvantage today in this game, is getting inside, creating contact, hitting their threes when they get a chance. Maybe some early nerves, though, Steve. Both teams with turnovers on their first possessions, shaking it off, now getting into the flow of the game a little bit more as we progress.
Yeah, these teams have had quite a bit of a layoff from the SODAC 16 round. That seems like almost a month ago. It was actually over 2 weeks, but that's a long time for these teams not to be in action. And there's a turnover. Cavaliers have it. Bohannon on the move. There's Bear. Sexer, he'll take the three. No, rolls off the rim, and there's Hinker clearing the rebound.
As we studied this matchup coming into the game today, you look at the season numbers, how these two teams play. They're very similar on the defensive side. The offensive side is a different story, though. But I could realistically see this game being in the mid-40s for each team,
yes.
Maybe a 50-point game. I don't think we're going to see as much offense in this game, but you're going to see some really good defense displayed between these two in this early matchup.
Sexer drives, has it blocked. Outlet, here come the Colonels on the move, but nothing there as Jefferson was back defensively. We'll go to the half court set. Colonels wearing the old school uniforms, and that shot floated up and no good by Talley. Sexer on the move. He's the main scorer for the Cavaliers and fires a pass out of bounds.
And again, Jefferson trying to find an inside game. They've taken a shot from deep, tried to get to their guard in the interior and see if he can't sneak past there. It was the right idea, right concept. They had Fields isolated on the right side all by himself. The pass just sailed over his head and out of bounds.
No score yet between the Colonels and the Cavaliers.
This is the type of offense the Colonels like. Kind of lull the defense into a nap if they can, pass it around, get the high percentage shots if they can. Neither team able to find nylon yet.
And that changes as Fields scores on a good pass to set him up.
And that was the exact same play they ran the last time down, just a more well-executed play. They got Fields in movement, got underneath the defense before they could get settled.
That three is no good by Soka. And the ball is out of bounds. It will go to the Cavaliers.
Taking a look at the numbers early on here today. 0 of 3
for Mitchell from the field. Two of them have been three-point shots. The deep looks aren't working, but they're not getting anything interior-wise yet. Jefferson continues to bottle that side of things up as they attack the interior again on the offensive side.
Bohannon with the drive, our first foul of the game, will go against Sokup, and that is his first. And here comes the sub. That's Parker Mandel, number 10, a 6'3 junior. He averages 4 points, 2.5 rebounds per game. Smith, 17 points per game, as is for Marcus Talley for Mitchell. And the inbounds will go out of bounds.
Looking at rebounding, it's going to be a big part of the game today. Mitchell right now just 2 rebounds as a team. Jefferson has doubled that with their 4 early, but neither team an offensive rebound early in this one. You have these misses like you do early on. You would hope that there would be second chance opportunities. That hasn't come yet, but both teams need to continue to stay aggressive on the offensive glass and see if they can't get those opportunities in the inside, especially with threes not falling early on in this one.
Here's a shot from the corner, in and out. Nothing but green jerseys underneath as Payne clears it away. Jefferson switched up to a man-to-man defense that last time down the court. Pass, Payne has to retrieve it. Now Fields open, that's well short. And that's gonna be an air ball out of bounds. Timeout on the court, 4:31 left, 2-0. Jefferson had a Mitchell low scoring game. Back in 1 minute on SDPB 3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
If you like defensive basketball, this is your game so far. 2-0, Jefferson and Mitchell here in our opening round contest, boys AA basketball in SDPV 3. Colonels have had some good looks, JJ. Shots just haven't fallen.
Really, it's been the three-point shooting so far. They're 0-4 from three-point land, Stephen. Again, they talk all the time when you come into this tournament, even back when we played in the old Sioux Falls arena, the bigger atmosphere, having more space behind the backboard sometimes can mess with the depth perception of a shooter. I'm not so sure that's a reality. It's kind of more of one of those urban legends, but you can see the shooting struggles right now for Mitchell early on in this one as they try to get accustomed to the court here today inside the Denny Sanford Promotion.
And it's going to be off of Smith. He thought it touched the Cavalier player. Smith with an astonished look on his face. He'll walk down to the other end of the court. Another turnover for Mitchell. That's 3 against them now.
Both teams with 3 turnovers here so far today. Neither team has taken great care of the ball on the offensive side. But again, you give credit to the defense. They've done a terrific job of holding these offensive players in check.
Oh, nice little up and under by Mason Payne, the 6'4 junior. He averages over 9.5 points and 7.5 rebounds per game for the Cavaliers. And now here comes the trap. They'll quickly settle back, man-to-man defense for the Cavaliers. They opened up in a zone. And here's a drive and a good look. Counted in the foul. That's Gavin Sokup.
Well, what a terrific decision. The shooting from three has not gone well so far for Mitchell, so just go and attack the rim. See if you can find a way inside. At worst, you're going to draw contact. Get to the free throw line. Now you've got a chance at a three-point play. That's a beautiful look at the rim and a great way to equalize this game offensively.
Fields with the foul for the Cavaliers. His first, team's first. Sokup at the line, 77% on the season. That one will rattle in. And Mitchell finally gets that goose egg off the scoreboard. They'll settle back in their man-to-man defense. Sexer spinning, floats it up and in. Boy, that didn't take him long.
That's a guy who scores almost 13 points a game, too, for this Jefferson team. He's such a good scorer. He knows what to do with the ball in his hands. He's the only guy scoring in double figures for his squad heading into this tournament.
Yeah, Jefferson has a pretty balanced lineup. That pass mishandled by Smith. He'll retreat to the perimeter. Now he'll put it on the floor. Oh, what a nice little give and go. And a foul on the miss by Solik. It's going against Jefferson. That was a beautiful play setup.
And as you look at the defender going up in the air that time, he didn't ever really get his feet set along with the shooter. You watch, he comes in number 34 on the backside, and the swat right there, had it not been for the body where the foul initially happened, probably would have gotten a foul on the volleyball type swat there at the end. You got to go up straight as a defender, hope to just deflect a shot, make the shooter shoot around you. Made it a little too easy to get to the hoop that time for Solik.
Solik makes the first of two opportunities, and he got them both. And just like that, it's a one-point game again.
Free throw shooting will keep you in a tournament when your offensive shooting is maybe lacking, and we've seen that so far from Mitchell here in the opening quarter. They haven't gotten a lot offensively from the floor yet, but now four of their 5 points have come at the free throw line.
Shot up and no good by Jace Unzen, who just checked into the game. But Mitchell saves it, and they'll get a layup by Soka.
Braylon Bear was so close to intercepting that one. He had his fingertips on it, but just didn't quite have enough strength to bring it back down.
That shot by Daniel Jones is blocked. Loose ball, foul on the transition.
We're starting to see a little momentum now with Mitchell taking their first lead of the day. That was some ultra-aggressive defensive ability over there on that side from the Colonels. And it looks like they're going to take a timeout, or rather, I should say, Sioux Falls Jefferson will take the 30-second timeout to talk things over. You're seeing improved defense from Mitchell, and it's turning into points and opportunities on the other end. It's a great last couple series there, specifically for Gavin Suka.
Yep, the Cavaliers went to the bench. Jace Unzen and Daniel Jones checking in, numbers 3 and 12 respectively. Both those players averaged 4 points per contest. Those are the main bench players for the Cavaliers, providing some scoring punch coming off the bench. So you get a look at the Mitchell-Colonel huddle there. They shoot 47.5% from the floor, 30% from beyond the arc. Only 61% as a team from the free throw line. That's been one of their struggles this year. Cavaliers 45% from the floor, 32% from beyond the arc, 62% at the free throw line.
Taking a look at the size right now for Mitchell as they come back out, going with that long lineup here against Jefferson as they try to keep guys out of foul trouble. A couple players starting to tally them up a little bit here early on in this one. So kind of playing that coaching chess match early, Steve, trying to get matchups, maybe find a little advantage where you can and see if you can't keep this game close.
Here's the pass to the outside. The three is short. Rebound to Smith. Shot no good. Foul on the rebound there by Parker Mandel, who's going to get some free throw opportunities. And that is Fields getting the foul. That's his second.
It's going to be a concern today for Sioux Falls Jefferson. If these starters get into foul trouble and have to miss any significant time out there, it could be tough for them. Let's see how this plays out now. Still a lot of time in this opening quarter and a lot of basketball yet to be played here today.
Solik to the bench. Gavin Henker coming back in for Mitchell. Free throw short. There's Smith with the rebound. No good. And the rebound pulled down by Sexer. 8-6. Mitchell on top. Sexer on the drive, floater up in the lane off the side of the iron, no good. And that's Talley with the rebound. He's quickly into the front court and scores.
That's the type of aggression that the Mitchell Colonels have really known from their guard position over the years. Go in with an attitude like, I'm going to score at the rim, but watch for your teammates. If the opportunity's there, pass it away, but be fearless in taking it. There's a big fearless shot there on the other end for Jefferson.
That was Demarius Fields with the tray. 10-9 the score.
First three-pointer for either team today. It was the eighth total three-point attempt of the game, the third for Jefferson, and they knocked down their first.
Here's Talley with the three. No good, but look at Smith coming in for the rebound. Colton Smith scores.
That's the third offensive rebound for Mitchell in this one, and it started to turn into some points. Second chance opportunities have started to become available in the interior on the other end for Mitchell.
Jones floats it up, tips it around, and Talley's on the move for Mitchell. Doesn't have the numbers. Here's a drive, a bounce pass to the baseline, and a score by Colton Smith. Now we're seeing Mitchell execute.
Yeah, this is the type of offense we were expecting to see today. I think just some early nerves coming into the tournament. When you're the number one seed, you've got that bullseye on your back. Everybody's looking at you. They're waiting to see when you're going to lose again. The 21 record is their best regular season finish in Mitchell High School basketball since 1985. There's a lot of eyes on this team right now, but they've started to settle into themselves and look like that team that earned a number one spot at this tournament.
5 seconds left. Pass to the outside. It's tipped away by Smith. The impressive thing about Colton Smith, this kid's just a sophomore.
Yeah. Yeah, youth is definitely an advantage, especially at high school levels here in South Dakota. Sometimes you can get these guys coming up as seventh graders and on at certain levels of this high school athletics. Having a sophomore that can lead your team, be a presence out there on the floor at the AA level, that's an advantage in a big way, and a player who can really set the tone for years to come here for this Mitchell squad. In Sioux Falls, Jefferson, remember, they got out to a 4-0 start in this game. Since then, Mitchell has just dominated offensively.
Oh, that almost went in off the glass. We're done with one. Mitchell, 14. Cavaliers, 9. Back with the second quarter in a moment right here on SDPB 3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
Getting ready for the second quarter of basketball here, our opening contest of the boys class AA basketball tournament. Along with JJ Hardigan, I'm Steve Toome. Mitchell didn't score for like the first 3.5+ minutes, but then their offense started clicking. They're up 14-9.
Yeah, it was a 4-0 start to the day for Sioux Falls Jefferson as Mitchell kind of worked through those early game shooting woes, but a 14-5 finish at the end of that first quarter. Mitchell found their groove offensively. They are 4-5 at the free throw line in this game right now, Steve. I think that really helped settle their nerves a little bit. Getting to the line for the first time, knocking a couple in, kind of helped them get their flow offensively going. They picked up intensity on this end of the floor as well, making it much more difficult for these Jefferson shooters to get clean looks at the rim.
Bohannon in the lane. He's in trouble. It's tapped around, but Jefferson keeps control. Here's a shot from the outside. No good. Smith up high on the miss by Braylon Bear. Talley quickly, no, but he'll get some free throws.
There was contact multiple times heading towards the rim there. We'll see what the officials rule this on. It'll be Bear picking up his second.
Mitchell, 11-6 rebounding advantage, including 3 offensive rebounds. No offensive rebounds so far for Jefferson.
Yeah, that's something to keep an eye on today. If you get second chance opportunities, you're going to be able to adapt after a miss, get those shots away. But if it's constantly a one-and-done opportunity, it's going to make it very difficult for this Jefferson team to stay in this game. Now with a 6-point deficit, it's ballooned to a 2-possession lead. It's the largest lead of the day for Mitchell. See how these Cavaliers respond over the next few minutes here in the second quarter.
Well, they're going to pump up a 3 by Fields, and Smith up high again for another rebound. Solik with the drive, shut off. There's the fake by Sokup, and it's going to go out of bounds. Who's it belong to? Mitchell.
And obviously, with the number one seed playing in this tournament, there's a few extra eyes watching this early game today. There are college coaches, college recruits being taken place here this weekend. They'll be watching a lot of these players, seeing if they can maybe find that next diamond in the rough. Seen already the South Dakota State coaching staff in attendance tonight.
Hinker gets the bucket there, and congratulations to South Dakota State. They punched two tickets to the NCAA, men's and women's, with conference championships. Sexer blocked by Smith. Tally can't save it from going out of bounds. Got a feeling number five from Mitchell, there's going to be some college scouts looking at this young man.
Probably, the way he plays on both ends of the floor. Reminds me a lot of Kalen Gary, guy who plays at South Dakota State. He's got that build, that size, that confidence, that bulldog attitude about him. Guy who played at DeSmit and had a great career up there, now earning his stripes with the Jackrabbits. Boy, that was a tough shot right there, over and outstretched Colton Smith.
Yeah, Sexer with the bucket there. He's setting off to USD to play football.
So many good athletes. This Jefferson team littered with football players on their roster as well.
Long three is good by Tally, a 33% shooter from beyond the arc.
That's a breath of fresh air for Mitchell, their first three of the day.
Tally tracks it down. Oh, but there's Smith with the follow. And a timeout call by Jefferson as the Cavaliers are in a bit of trouble.
Yeah, this is the dangerous part about this Mitchell team. I think Jefferson early on had the advantage, Steve, just by the way they were playing, the energy they came out with early on. They hit a couple shots to take that lead, but since then, Mitchell has clamped down defensively. It's turned into big point opportunities on the offensive side, and all of a sudden, they're shooting right underneath 50%, 47% for the day, 8 of 17 from the field. They've hit their first three of the day now as well, and things are starting to look up for these Mitchell Colonels. Be sure to follow South Dakota Public Broadcasting, SDPB Sports, on your mobile device all season long. Check out our Facebook page, Twitter, and Instagram as well. Be sure to check them all out and check in the action and the award photos by searching SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching from. Read some of the great stories and watch some of our videos that feature our teams, our kids, and our coaches here in South Dakota.
Mitchell, 8 of 17 from the floor, 47%. Cavaliers, 5 of 15, 33%. Turnovers roughly even, but the rebounding battle is 13 to 7. Advantage Mitchell. And Mitchell seems to have found their stride here from about the 2-minute mark on at the last couple of minutes of that first quarter. Coming into this second quarter, they are playing like the team that we have seen all year long, the number one team in the state. Sexer fires three, got it. That's just what the doctor ordered for the Cavaliers.
What a good time out there by head coach Tim Reck. He's noticed that his team is maybe laboring a little bit. You get to that double digit lead, you want to settle the nerves, get them back in line with what your game plan is. This is a team that's won six in a row getting to this state tournament. They've played good basketball as well.
Hinker with the dunk and a great pass by Tally.
And he can fly. If they can get him open inside, look out. But again, this Jefferson team, there doesn't need to be any panic in their game right now. Just keep doing what you're doing. It's going to hit.
Bohannon knocks down a big three, his first points of the game.
The three-point bucket is the equalizer, especially nowadays with how much offenses utilize three-point shooting. It's become such a big part of the game. Everybody wants to be Steph Curry and shoot the half-court three-point bucket. Sometimes just finding your sweet spot, or even maybe just giving it to your big man and saying, go on in. That's an easy way to do it. But this Mitchell team has started to hit from both ends, inside and out. Their offense looks pretty complete right now.
Tally with the drive, and he'll have to pass it to the outside where Solik will handle it. Great patience. A little screen at the free throw line freed up Tally, and a good defensive rebound by Payne.
Let's see what kind of energy this Jefferson team has here offensively. Again, keep attacking, good things will happen. And there, Andre Fields, his son, Demarius Fields, driving right inside. Kind of playing like a football player there for a moment as he went in attacking the defense.
Tally with the foul, his first. Remember, team fouls reset after every quarter. Then it's the double bonus. New rules for boys basketball this year. Bohannon with the ball. Trying to get inside, and oh, that's a nice move by Bohannon as he managed to get around Soka.
inside game is going to be so important today for Jefferson. Again, their size is not there compared to Mitchell, but being able to attack, being able to go up amongst the trees and find those layups, those high percentage shots, it's going to keep them in this game.
And we're going to have an offensive foul on Hinker. And that's going to lead us to a timeout on the court. 4:37 left to go here. Here is quarter number two. Mitchell up 24-19. Back in 1 minute on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live. Where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Get a look at the Mitchell cheering section here inside the Sanford Premier Center along with J.J. Hardigan. I'm Steve Toome. Jefferson's made their last four field goals in a row, and they've managed to cut was an 11-point deficit, cut it down to five.
Yeah, at one point it was a 14-5 run there for Mitchell. They even ballooned it out a little bit more than that. But here as of late, Jefferson started to hit some threes. They've gotten their inside game to kind of roll along with the offense here today. The shooting percentages look pretty even right now. 8 of 18 for Sioux Falls. Jefferson from the field, 3 of 7 from deep. Mitchell, 9 of 19 from the field, just 1 of 7 from deep. Where they've stayed ahead in this game, though, 5 of 7 already at the free throw line.
Trying to set the high screen. It frees up Bohannon off the back iron. Tipped around a couple of times and into the hands of the Colonels. Quick outlet, and there's a bump. No shot. It was on the floor. On the drive by Sokup, and for Braylon Bear, I think that's his third personal foul. And it is.
Yep. That's a tough one. Coach Reck wanted to leave him in there because they love his aggression out there, but with the personal foul picked up, his third.
Jace Unzen, Daniel Jones checking in for the Cavaliers. Mitchell plays it in, and they will get the basket underneath.
So now a defender down here for Jefferson. They bring in a little more offense off the bench to try to equalize that. We'll have to see what kind of emphasis they put on the inside-outside game now to try to keep this offense moving along for the Cavaliers.
Sexer got into trouble, and he'll have to throw it to the outside. Still 15 on the shot clock for Jefferson. Fields lost the handle, picked up by Hinker. Tally, Smith. And I think he took an extra step. Yep, turnover. Maybe get away with that in the NBA, but not here.
Yep. And again, the Cavaliers on the other end, they're trying to find big number 50, Mason Payne, the 6'4 forward that they've got on this roster here. Mitchell has done a terrific job of bottling him up. They've had Gavin Hinker on him for much of this game, and at times they've double-teamed him. At last time, Fields had to try to go inside simply because Payne wasn't there. And again, they're trying to get it to the big man. The defense from Hinker is forcing him up near the free throw line and keeping the ball out around the perimeter right now for Jefferson. This has just been terrific defense in this first half here from the Mitchell Colonels.
Fields lines up a three, no good. Smith clears it away. Sokup with the ball, back to Smith, the layup, yes. 8 for Smith.
Boy, and the transition game is so smooth for Mitchell. They get out and run with some of the best in this state.
3 is no good, and Smith up high for another rebound. He'll look to move up court. Accelerates, but that one no good. Here comes the Cavaliers with Unzen. Payne will swing it out to Fields. Nice fakes. Tried to step through a couple of defenders. Sexer was bumped along the baseline. He's bottled up. They'll have to reset with Fields. Sexer for three. That's going to be short of the mark. And Tally clears that one away. Talley lost the handle. Now Smith underneath, slapped out of his hands with a foul. That is on Mason Payne, his first. Check it out on the replay.
Just great ball movement again from Mitchell, finding a little seam in the defense. And really, I think if you keep Mason Payne stationary there and just let him go up, you take a chance and hope that the shooter will miss on a little scoop shot up and under type of play. Instead, you get up in the air and you try to make up for it by slapping at that basketball, and it draws the foul in. This Mitchell team now at the line for their ninth free throw attempt here already today.
Short, and we had a lane violation.
Yeah, a lane violation. Stepping in a little early that time was Daniel Jones, so they'll reset to another one here.
That's a benefit for Mitchell because Smith missed it, so it's another opportunity. 62% on the year. That one bounces away, no good, and Jones skies for the rebound.
That's something they need more of, and getting him off the bench and getting him a chance to come out now and utilize that leaping ability might help Jefferson get some second chance opportunities, a few more rebounds.
They get an offensive rebound there. Payne, the mid-range jumper, yes. He's got four.
You can get him involved in the offense. This Jefferson team has a real chance to provide an upset here today, but haven't had that many shot attempts for Payne yet. In fact, that's just his second shot of the game. He's a perfect 2-for-2 from the field. He's been very efficient in 11 minutes, but just two shots in 11 minutes isn't nearly enough for one of your best offensive options.
Yeah, he just hasn't had the opportunities. He just hasn't had the clean looks. Smith, 10 on the shot clock. Tries to go back door. Kicks it outside. Sokup, no good. Sutton Thompson tracking down the rebound. New shot clock. Smith, travel. Turnover, Mitchell.
I thought, at least from my seat, that's the best defensive stand we've seen from Jefferson here yet so far today. They took away some early passing lanes, made the Colonels really work for an open shot near the end of that. The one negative, again, another offensive rebound for Mitchell. That's already their sixth, but in all, a great defensive opportunity there. I think they're going to say somebody stepped out of bounds on the baseline.
Yep, turnover for Jefferson.
Cavaliers would love another stop here to try to cut this to a two-possession game, really make it interesting here in the final minute of this opening half of play.
Shot no good by Sokup.
Parker Mandel, Johnny on the spot again with that rebound. Another offensive board turns into a bucket for Mitchell. It's back to a 10-point lead now again.
Shot blocked by Smith on the attempt by Bohannon. Mandel on the runout, short. And it's out of bounds off of Jones. It'll stay with Mitchell. 42.7 seconds left.
Coach Kreutzfeld has to be very pleased with the way his team has ran the ball in the first half, up and down the floor in transition, making this Jefferson team turn into a track meet a little bit as they try to keep up with Mitchell in the ground game.
Mandel in trouble. Throws it to the outside. Talley for three. No. Thompson clears it away. And there's going to be a blocking foul. It's going to be on Payne.
Boy, the attack just relentless for Mitchell. Miss after miss. They get the offensive board and then go right back into the rim. This time, the contact drawn in as Payne left the open shooter alone. Sukup will have a chance to go to the line now. We're hearing some of the fans not necessarily agreeing with what they saw on the video replay, and our officials are going to talk about this for a moment.
No shot. Yep. Two free throws.
Yep. Again, the only thing that maybe changed that from being a charge to a blocking foul, the feet were in motion for the defender there as he slid over. He wasn't set ahead of the time as the offensive player attacked. That's one of the harder calls to make as an official, but they made the right one there. This crew has done a terrific job here in this first half of really balancing it out, letting these guys play while still maintaining the rules of the game. And that's a good call there by one of these three Zebras.
Sokup with 8 points. Make it one. Oh, we got players tumbling over each other. Referee right there. Mandel and Jones got tangled up. Shot clock will be off here. Mitchell up by 12 as we wind down quarter number two. Mitchell outscoring Jefferson so far 19-12 here in quarter number two. Jefferson playing for the final opportunity, looking for some momentum. Carry him into the second half. Sexer, guarded by Smith. The drive, got it. Tough bucket. 6 seconds left. There's time for Mitchell to get a shot off. Solek fires. Too strong off the window. And that's how the first half will end. Mitchell up by 10 points, 33-23. Back in a moment on SDPB 3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
Mitchell up by 10 here at halftime. First game of the day on SDPB 3, 33-23 our score. You know, with all sports, there are challenges that come along with it. For a senior at Brandon Valley, one key challenge extends off the court.
The sounds of the game of basketball are familiar to the Althoff family.
You know, whether it's the PA announcers, you know, introducing the players. The cheerleaders leading the cheers. It's been something that has kind of resonated with us, I think, here these last few years for sure.
The Althoffs' love of the game continued on with all of their children, including the youngest, Josh.
My brothers always played growing up, so I always went to their games and just had fun watching them, so I figured I'd play.
While Josh appreciates the game of basketball, he's got a greater appreciation for the sounds of the game, as he was born deaf.
Every newborn, it turns out, is screened for hearing. And when she did Josh's hearing screening, she did not find any vibrations or brain waves that he was hearing sound. So she let me know that she had serious concerns about significant hearing loss in both ears. Yeah. And that was all the information we were given before he was discharged from the hospital. And that started us on our journey of having him evaluated and figuring out that he had a profound hearing loss.
With a lot of research and a new job opportunity for Brent in Memphis, Tennessee, the Althoffs were able to find a way for Josh to hear with a cochlear implant.
The blessing was that in Sioux Falls, there was a physician who would do the cochlear implant surgery, but he would not do it in Sioux Falls. And he'd only done 6 patients. When we got to Memphis, we got him at to be seen by a physician who had implanted over 160 kids. And it was, the surgery ended up being at the Children's Hospital, and he was able to get both sides implanted at once.
We did a lot of research, considered the impact of, raising, a son through the deaf community versus, the cochlear implant option. And, it wasn't an easy decision. We didn't know what was truly best for him, but having older brothers, we just felt that, the cochlear implant would be a better option for our family and, trusted in God.
I'm definitely happy that they did, because without it, there's a lot of things about my life that would have been different, a lot of things that I wouldn't have been able to do. So I'm definitely happy for sure.
Now Josh is leading the links on the hardwood with full hearing, as long as he's got his ears on.
You really don't notice it a whole lot. It might fall off once in a while if he gets hit hard on a foul or something like that, but the guys are good at relaying the information, making sure if he's on the other end of the court that they're saying it a second or third time closer to him, get the message passed. He's good at just looking and dialing in and reading lips like everybody should, but he's really learned that he's got to really have eye focus and make sure he's doing that. But man, the expectations are just the same, and Josh wouldn't have it any other way.
Just that as long as you got the right attitude and the right work ethic, they can't really hold you back. It means a lot, because without the cochlear implants, I wouldn't be able to hear that. And it just reminds me that it's kind of a gift that I've been given, so I'm very thankful for it.
SDPB recently produced a program entitled Tales from the Hardwood, which featured Josh's stories and others. Go to sdpb.org/basketball. Watch Tales from the Hardwood, the 2024 edition today. We'll be back with more from the Class AA Boys Basketball Tournament after this timeout on SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
We've got a 10-point lead for Mitchell at halftime of our first game, first quarterfinal game here at the Boys AA Basketball Tournament, along with J.J. Hardigan. I'm Steve Toome, and let's check out some of the highlights from the first half. Mitchell had a bit of a scoring drought early on as they had to rely on their defense to carry them as Fields got open through that nice little backdoor cut there. Bohannon had a nice second quarter, So you see Payne getting loose there for the Cavaliers. They jumped out to the 4-0 lead, but then Mitchell started executing well on offense, JJ.
Yeah, and once they started hitting their stride, it was lookout time for these Jefferson Cavaliers. Mitchell so aggressive on both ends of the floor as far as their rebounding abilities are concerned. Their ability to step out and shoot improved as the game went on. They've started, I believe, 0-5 from three before they finally hit one. But that inside-outside game, they can move the ball like that and move in transition. There's really no stopping this Mitchell team. Jefferson has matched that at times, though, with their ability to get to the hoop. And as long as they can continue that, Steve, in the second half, I think you're going to see these shooting percentages stay pretty even. The big one, the goose egg, though, at the free throw line right now. Zero trips to the line in the first half for Jefferson. Mitchell hit their free throws, 8 of 11. And really, that's the difference in this game. It's a 10-point game. You'd be talking about a one-possession game if you wash out those free throws right now from Mitchell. Jefferson has to try to equalize that in the second half. Find ways to get to the line and get some of these Mitchell Colonels in foul trouble and see what that bench looks like over there for Mitchell. It's not an easy thing to do against a team like this, but the challenge is there. They know what they have to do. Tim Reck is a terrific coach. I'm sure he's made those dialed up halftime adjustments to try to get his guys back in line with this team.
The other stat that jumped out at me, rebounding, 24-11 advantage Mitchell. Just two offensive rebounds. Meanwhile, Mitchell with 10 offensive rebounds. If you're the underdog team in any sport, well, especially in basketball, there's certain stats you cannot let another team dominate. Offensive rebound in basketball, that's right at the top of the list.
Yeah, free throws and offensive rebounding, that's something that will drive a head coach absolutely crazy. If you're not executing on that end of the floor, it's going to be very hard to win basketball games. I guarantee you that was talked about in the locker room at halftime between both coaches and making that a point of emphasis, continuing to attack the offensive glass, finding inside opportunities just like that.
Yep, Jefferson went to his zone and the great penetration by Talley freed up Hinker for the easy basket underneath. Great execution there by Mitchell. So they go man-to-man. Sexer lost the handle opportunity. Colonels on the move with Talley. He'll lay it up with the right hand and score.
Four quick points for Mitchell. Did the math here, and as far as Sioux Falls Jefferson is concerned, the third quarter has traditionally been their best offensive quarter of the season.
Oh, what a play there by Fields. Not just with the rebound, but the acrobatic shot.
So athletic. He provides so much versatility. This is a guy who plays defensive back for the football team. He's a good point guard for the Sioux Falls Jefferson team and does a lot of things, a lot of heart, a lot of hustle out there. There's a lot of guys like that for Sioux Falls Jefferson that play that way. They play with some grit to them. There's a reason why they made it into the consolation championship game a year ago. They were on the edge of making it to the title game. They're looking to repeat, but that eight seed, when you have to get matched up first game of the tournament on day one of the tournament against the top seed, that is a daunting task in front of this Jefferson group.
And there's going to be a turnover against Mitchell. Talley tried to move on the baseline, wanted to give it to Hinker, but that play was broken up by the Cavaliers.
Again, getting back to that thought about the third quarter being great for Jefferson. The second and third quarters of the season, when you math it out, it's about 13.5 points per quarter. They score almost 17 points per quarter in the third, so that's a 4-point increase. And you can see there's just kind of that renewed confidence about them right now as they come out on the floor here in the third quarter here today, getting to the free throw line now for the first time as well.
Yep, Bohannon gets there on the foul by Sokup, his second. And the free throw good gives him 6 points on the afternoon. Tyler Bohannon, a senior, 55%, averages 8.7 points, 2 rebounds per game. Two big free throws there, gives him 7 points, and that's what Jefferson needs to do. Get to the foul line, score without time ticking off the clock. A little high screen there. A lot of contact, and they're gonna call an offensive foul on Sokup. Said he pushed off.
And that's a good call. You can see Gavin just kind of trying to create some separation between he and the defender. Lowered the shoulder just enough, and with the official right behind him there, he had a clear-cut look at it. It's a really good call by the officials. I know the Mitchell fans don't necessarily like it.
Oh, nice move, and there's Payne to clean it up off the miss by Sexer. That was a well-executed play by Jefferson.
Just didn't have opportunities like that in the first half. Getting an offensive rebound and a chance to put it right back. Payne was bottled up almost the entire first half. So finding ways to create some space for him to get to the rim, even if it is a rebounding opportunity, they need him down low.
There's going to be a foul on the rebound, and that's going to be against Jefferson. Tyler Bohannon, his second.
The fouls are starting to mount up a little bit here for Sioux Falls. Jefferson right now, Bear, three personals. Payne has two. Bohannon's picked up his second.
Gavin Hinker, just a 36% free throw shooter on the year, but he makes the first. He's got seven on the afternoon. Make it eight.
Younger brother of course, Caden Hinker, who has a great year for the Mitchell Colonels, has taken his game to another level with Augustana University at the double A ranks. Had a great season with Augustana this year.
Yep, and that Division II, tough Division II conference in basketball, the Northern Sun.
They just had their tournament in Sioux Falls across town about 10 days ago. A lot of these players from the AA ranks find themselves, along with those teams, moving on to the next level.
There's a drive by Talia that shut off. Yeah, we got to see Caden play a couple of years ago at AA. He is an impressive player, 6'8", and could just do everything on the basketball court.
He was one of, if not the best players in South Dakota during his senior year. And this Mitchell team lost a lot when they lost him, but they have regrouped in a big way, and this is a great group they've got on the floor here this year.
Hinker got it after the rebound, Gavin Hinker. Another rebound and another bucket. Now the lead back up to 12. Bohannon looking to drive, has to give away. Sexton will fire it. That's a three that's short. And there is Sokup with the rebound. Tally on the move. Will it count? Yes, it will. Foul will be on Sexer, I believe, his second.
See Sukup going to the sidelines. He doesn't go there very often. It'll likely be just a short breather for him, but three games in 3 days, you got to try to buy your time, keep your legs under you if you can, and maybe an opportunity here for Coach Kreitzfeldt and his coaching staff to get his guys some rest now with the lead ballooning up to 15 points.
Down low, Payne is open and finishes with the left hand. Nice play by the Cavaliers. Yeah, your bench so important, especially if you're the higher seed, and if you can build a lead, you got to lean on those guys to give those starters a rest. Bounce pass in the paint, tapped away. Sexer on the move. Fields. Oh, I think he took an extra step and might have gotten away with it as Bohannon scores. He's got nine.
Yeah, that's just a smart pass there. You're right. I think maybe the extra step, he got away with one, but still seeing the floor cleanly, finding his open teammate, turned into a transition bucket for Jefferson, which they rely on quite a bit.
Oh, that one rolled in and out. Almost got tipped back in. And we're going to have a foul on Tally.
Boy, if that would have gone in on the tip, that would have been one of those highlight reel whoopsie type shots. But Jefferson can breathe a sigh of relief there for just a moment.
Mitchell up by 11. Timeout on the court. We'll be back in 1 minute right here on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour. You know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
Oh, my goodness.
Fourth 13. 14 left to go, third quarter. Mitchell up 44-33.
SDPB is your home for the 2024 State Basketball Championships. You can check them out, sdpb.org/basketball, where you'll find the action and award photos, stories, statistics, brackets, and so much more. Visit sdpb.org/basketball to expand your hoops experience in South Dakota.
Yep, they're just getting underway out West River. That's where Class A is this year. And, of course, Class B up in Aberdeen. We are in Sioux Falls. This is the Class AA Boys Basketball Tournament. I'm Steve Toom. He's J.J. Hartigan. We're back in the saddle again for some more great basketball action. As Jefferson looking to rally. Payne has to throw it outside. Fields handles it now. Mid-range jumper, yes.
Again, that renewed confidence for Sioux Falls. Jefferson coming out of the locker room at halftime. They kind of shot themselves in the foot by turning over the ball in their first possession, and it turned into an early 4-0 run for Mitchell here in the third quarter. But since then, Sioux Falls Jefferson has been in the driver's seat offensively and have looked like a much different team here in the second half.
Yep, they're still getting out rebounded 2-1, but the shooting stats are pretty even. Mandel down low. Hinker trying to muscle it up, too strong. Rebound fought for. Payne clears the way. Foul. So it's going to be on Mitchell.
Boy, Payne has been the equalizer so far for Jefferson. He has really been aggressive on the glass, in particular on the defensive side. That's twice now in the last couple of minutes where he's forced one of the Mitchell players to commit a foul because of his aggression underneath the hoop. They got to keep finding ways to get him involved on the offensive end as well.
That last foul is on Colton Smith, but here's a takeaway. Hinker now for Mitchell. Solek, the drive, too strong. Mandel, he'll retreat. Hinker tries the interior pass, and Smith with the finish. Smith with 11. Love the balance that Mitchell has shown this afternoon. Both teams have pretty balanced scoring. Oh, what a nifty play by Fields.
He's looking really good. 4 of 7 so far today. He's up to 9 points. He's made a three. 4 turnovers is something he's going to have to try to slow down a little bit, but he's taken a much better care of the basketball. He's been facilitating his teammates as well. He's keeping this Jefferson team in the game right now with his offensive abilities.
Yeah, he averages a little over 8 points per game, and he's having a nice afternoon. 10 on the shot clock. Smith, here's the drive by Talley, and he gets the easy layup.
Talley's such a hard player to keep track of because he's so strong on the ground. The way he runs the floor, he'll pick up a foul here. But on the other end, Talley was just relentless, running around the defense until he finally broke free and got the bucket. Cavaliers kind of gave him a taste of his own medicine there on that end as he picks up the personal foul.
Talley just got his third foul for Mitchell.
And fouls are going to be a concern for both teams the rest of the way. Bear has 3 on the other end for Sioux Falls Jefferson. You can see both teams kind of making some moves accordingly at the scorer's table. We'll have some guys checking in here after the free throw.
Yep, Bohannon back at the line, 2 of 2 on the afternoon. That'll be Edward Whiting coming in. He'll give Payne a break for the Cavaliers. And now Mitchell trying to sort out who they're going to get into the contact. Talley's going to go to the bench. Gavin Soka back in, number 12.
I think he would have liked to keep Gavin on the bench a little bit longer. Again, trying to find some minutes to get him some rest throughout the tournament. Back in because of the foul issues.
And that one will eat a lot of iron, but it will fall. And now Bohannon out. Jace Unzen, number 3, in for the Cavaliers. Cavaliers still down by 10. They've got a couple of minutes left to go here in this third quarter to try to cut into this Mitchell lead. Soka pulls up. Yes. He's got 11.
He just looks like you could throw him into a game back in the 1950s, the 1980s, the early 2000s. Doesn't matter. He probably would have fit in real nice with what the Mitchell Colonels were doing offensively. He's just got a very old school mentality about him. He runs the floor well, as you can see here, and he finds his teammates always active, whether the ball's in his hands or not. Really enjoy watching number 12, and he's going to be a player to keep an eye on the rest of the way because of the chaos that he can create on the floor.
Out of bounds, it goes to the Cavaliers. 92 seconds left to go in this third quarter. It's still a 10-point lead for Mitchell. See if the Cavaliers, they really need to cut at least to single digits before we start the fourth period of play.
This is a huge possession. You don't need to rush anything here, but you've got to come away with points, and that's not what you needed on that one.
See if Mitchell can capitalize on the turnover. They'll back it out with Sokup to set up the offense with Solek. Smith posting up against Bear, who's got the three fouls, and that might be foul number four. What a quick move by Smith. And Braylon Bear just got his fourth personal foul.
Yeah, that's huge.
It is. Smith back to the line. He's got 11 points on the afternoon. Short on the free throw. Here comes Jones in to replace Braylon Bear for the Cavaliers.
These two teams, as I look through the numbers, pretty even as far as turnovers per game are concerned. Mitchell, right around 11 and a half turnovers per game as a team. Sioux Falls Jefferson, around 12. Both teams have 9 turnovers today, and I think really where the game's being won right now is what Mitchell's been able to do with the basketball after turnovers. They missed the free throw here, but they've capitalized quite a bit today on points off of turnovers, points in transition after passing mistakes. Now here, foul's gonna get us walking down to the other end of the floor with some free throws coming up for Jefferson. That could play a role in this game here. If Jefferson can keep getting to the line like we've seen in this third quarter, Steve, this could be a very different game. Didn't have a single free throw in the first half, but now have been busy at that line since here in the third quarter.
Yep, that's the 15th foul on Mitchell, so the double bonus for the rest of the quarter. Jones misses the free throw on the year. 51% for the 6'1 senior, averages 4 points, 2 rebounds per game. And he got that one. Lead is 9. A minute to go.
Jefferson can't afford a foul here. Again, they've been in a little bit of foul trouble. I think you're okay with giving up a bucket if it's a hard-earned one, but you don't need the foul over like that. Now a chance at a 3-point play. Pushes this lead back to 11 and a chance to make it 12 with less than a minute to go in the quarter.
Whiting got the foul. And the interior passing today for Mitchell has been stellar.
Yep.
Sutton Thompson's gonna give Sokup a break. Colton Smith missed his last 4 free throws in a row, but he makes that one, gets the old-fashioned 3-point play. That's a big play for Mitchell, because now the lead is a dozen. We approach the end of the third quarter.
If it's to a tie, you know, a 10-point game, maybe a 9-point game before the end of the quarter, that's a huge win for Jefferson.
Fields pulls up high off the window. Nice play. Fields with 13.
It's a really soft touch, too. Again, you know the defenders are coming up to try to disrupt that shot, and being 5'6 against a 6'4 guy, you have to put a little extra finesse on it sometimes. That was a really good finish there from Fields.
And over and back called, and the Mitchell fans not happy at all.
That's a good call again. There was no change in possession. It got tipped. Perhaps, but not before it got redirected and went over the line. And I think even Coach Tim Rex says, okay, maybe we got away with one there a little bit, but you look,
he touched it.
Yeah, again, in the backfield there, the official saw it. That's a good call. They've been right on top of it all day.
Well, Jefferson's got to come away with points. Under 10 seconds, Fields will reset. Sexer looking. Fields pulls up, wild shot off the mark. I think that was the play Jefferson wanted. It's 53-43. Mitchell on top after three quarters. Back in a minute. SDPB3.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship. Because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
You know, look at some of the fans here, maybe in the mood a little early for St. Patrick's Day.
Why not? You got Jefferson in attendance with their green as well. Might as well make it a whole weekend affair here. We will have, not technically on St. Patrick's Day since it's on Sunday this year, but our championship game, I got a feeling we're going to see a lot of green and shamrocks here all throughout the day on Saturday. There'll be parties going on all around Sioux Falls to celebrate St. Patrick's Day, but every day is St. Patty's Day when you're the Jefferson Cavaliers. You got the green on, having some fun. Maybe some fans a little bit nervous in the stands right now. I don't think a 10-point lead for Mitchell in this stage of the game feels all that comfortable. This Jefferson team feels like they've got a run still left in them. They've got to be really efficient with the basketball here over the final 10 minutes. Just 9% from three-point land today is Mitchell. Not much better for Jefferson, just 3 of 12.
Soakup misses. Fields tips it outside. On the run, Unzin, and he gets the layup. His first points. That's just what the doctor ordered for the Cavaliers. They'll sink back in that zone defense. They're going to switch it up man-to-man now.
Closest we've been since the end of the first quarter as far as point differential. It's an eight-point game.
Boy, a scramble for the loose ball. Still on the court, finally. We're going to have a jump ball. Possession arrow favors the Cavaliers. And ooh. Smith comes up limping for Mitchell, number five. And he's a player they cannot afford to lose. He's going to stay in the game, but he's definitely favoring that right leg. Talking to the referee about something about that scramble for the loose ball.
Yeah, I mean, there were bodies flying everywhere there. I would imagine somebody maybe had an elbow and arm, something get tangled up. I'm sure it was incidental, but still, you don't like to see a player walk away injured like that.
Rebound pulled down by Mitchell, and there's Unzin with the foul. Remember, team fouls reset at the quarter break. You get to five, it's the double bonus.
You can tell there's a sense of urgency right now for this Jefferson team, the number 8 team in this tournament, sensing that they've got a chance maybe to take this game back into their hands. Don't need to be making careless mistakes with the basketball, committing a foul that could cost you a chance at a big run.
Talley misses on the three, and there's Unzin with the weak side rebound for Jefferson. Fields is open for three. Good!
He has been huge today for his team. His seventh make from the field.
He's got 16 points.
It's a second made three of the day. Got to keep the intensity up on this end, though, for Jefferson. Can't slack in and let Mitchell get comfortable. And can't allow them to play their games offensively and get back to the free throw line either.
Hinkle in the paint, puts it up, off the mark. Rebound, Unzin on the weak side.
Credit Payne there. That was great defensive execution. Stayed in front of the offensive player the entire way. Didn't bend. Didn't allow the shot to go off easily.
Bohannon gives away to Sexer. Sexer's only scored 2 points here in the second half, but there's Unzin. Yes, on the three.
Here we go. 2-point game with under 6 to play. Jefferson has come out gangbusters here in this second half. It's game on here in this 1-versus-8 matchup.
Pass down low. Hinkle is going to be fouled. That stops the momentum currently. And that is going to be on Sexer, but that's his third.
Yeah, that's deep three. NBA range. They've got the two ups here inside the Dennis Sanford Premier Center. That one was from well beyond NBA range with that big 3-point bet.
Mitchell has called a timeout. They want to talk things over as their lead. which was 10 just a moment ago, has evaporated down to just 2 points. An 8-0 start to this quarter by Jefferson. And JJ, you called it right at the start of the quarter. Mitchell had a 10-point lead, but normally for Mitchell, that's pretty solid going into the fourth quarter, but things just didn't seem quite right. And Jefferson, even though they missed that last shot at the end of the third quarter, looked out of sorts, they have been executing very well here at the start of the fourth quarter.
Yeah, it's an 8-0 run in the quarter. You could even balloon that out a little bit further. At one point, Mitchell, I believe, led by 15 in this game. It's the largest lead for either team in this matchup here today. But the last 3 minutes of basketball time has been all Sioux Falls Jefferson. They have brought a different level of intensity out onto the floor. Their sharpshooters are finally connecting. And when they're able to get those rebounds and make life difficult for these Mitchell post players in the interior, when Mason Payne is executing defensively like he has been in this fourth quarter, you can see why this Jefferson team is as good as they are, why they've won 12 games, six in a row. They had their struggles at the midway point of the season, actually lost 5 of 6 at one point at the middle of the year, but haven't lost since then, including that Sodak 16 win that you mentioned was an overtime thriller against Rapid City Stevens. That was the tune-up they needed. They are conditioned for playoff basketball right now. State tournament basketball time. It's finally here. They're living up to the moment, back within this game in a 2-point contest.
Hinker in the paint outside to Mandel. Oh, what interior passing, and there's the dunk!
One-handed dunk there, and that is a exclamation point. Dot, dot with Gavin Hinker right there. He threw it down with authority, reminded everybody in this building who the number one seed is at this tournament.
Well-executed play by Mitchell. Their interior passing, again, has been stellar all afternoon. Payne up and under is fouled. Boy, a lot of contact there. And they're going to catch, I think, Mandel reaching in with the foul, his second. And we've got a timeout on the court with 4:57 left to go. Mitchell up by 4, back in 1 minute, right here on SDPB3.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Mitchell ahead of Jefferson, just under 5 minutes left to go in regulation, along with J.J. Hardigan. I'm Steve Toome here at the AA Boys Basketball Tournament. We're inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. Mitchell had a comfortable 10-point lead, but Jefferson with some momentum, opening up the fourth quarter with quite a bang.
Yeah, it was an 8-0 run. They did allow the bucket just a moment ago to kind of slow things down, but couldn't ask for a better start to this fourth quarter for Sioux Falls Jefferson. They've upped their shooting percentage now overall in the game today, Steve, to 50%. And they're starting against the free throw line. Didn't have a single free throw attempt in that first half. This will be their 7th and 8th tries at the line here today.
Payne connects, and just got to remind people, a week ago, looked like O'Gorman was going to pull away from Rapid City Stevens at the girls' AA in that 1-8 matchup. Then Stevens came rallying back, sent that one into overtime before O'Gorman finally prevailed. But kind of the same script here. O'Gorman was up comfortably, and all of a sudden, Stevens hit 3 3-pointers, and all of a sudden, a big lead turned into a tie ball game in the blink of an eye. Down low, Smith, short, rebound, Talley has it. New shot clock for Mitchell. Boy, they have just lived on the offensive glass today. That was offensive rebound number 15. Tally, three, bingo!
That's such a big shot there for these Mitchell Colonels. Tally, one of four players in double figures today for Mitchell.
Sexer, no! But he'll get some free throws. That one just couldn't quite crawl over the rim. And that foul will be on Colton Smith. That is his second, team's second.
Both teams have four players in double figures today. They've gotten their benches involved just a little bit, but only six scorers for each team today. That tells you how important your starting five are. Jefferson got into their fair share of foul trouble early on in this game. Bear has been stuck with four fouls for much of this contest. He's only taken one shot in this game. Bohannon, Sexer, they've each got three. But now on the other end, Tally and Sokup each have three as well. Something to keep an eye on here over the last 4 minutes.
Two big misses there by Sexer, a 60% free throw shooter.
Steve, it kind of feels right now like the Colonels maybe weathered the storm. Like they got through the worst of that Jefferson run there that got them back into a one possession game. It's back to a 5-point lead now for Mitchell. They can execute well here. They've got a chance to establish themselves again.
Shot missed by Hinker. Bohannon on the move, doesn't have the numbers. Fields, great fake, pulls up, short of the mark, but there's Payne. Blocked by Smith into the hands of Mitchell. Bounds. And I think that Solik just couldn't stop his momentum. It'll go to Jefferson. Watch this. Oh, perfect timing.
I think the only thing Payne maybe could have done there to prevent that, go with the old school power dribble, get that defender up in the air. His momentum was like a pogo stick that time. He was going to bounce right back up. If you can get him up and then draw that contact, you're at the line. But again, you go, you try to get that quick offensive rebound, lay it in. Just great defensive execution there. And you don't want to discredit Mason Payne by any means. He has had a wonderful second half here for this Jefferson team. His play on both ends of the floor really have been a big part of what has allowed Jefferson to get back in this one. I think you're just seeing high-level defense here from the AA tournament from both ends of the floor. This number one Mitchell team may be trying to just hold out here for these final 3 minutes and 40 seconds. Hold this number eight Jefferson team at bay long enough. But it has been a real challenge here today for both teams.
You know, In Play with Craig Maddock features in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. And through these conversations, we learn about the players, programs, and legends who help shape the current sports scene here in the Mount Rushmore City. You'll find the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcast. And be sure to leave us a five-star review so that others can find them. It's In Play with Craig Maddock.
Top two scorers today, Fields has 16 for Jefferson, Tally has 16 for Mitchell. I think those two are going to maybe put their fingerprints on this game another time or two before it's set and done.
And that's a pretty safe bet there as Fields gives way. Bohannon, Payne maneuvers, trying to post up, doesn't have anything. Wants the screen. Now Payne again spins, gets loose on the baseline. Here's the open shooter. It's Sexer. No. But Payne collects an offensive rebound. And he puts it in off the window. He's got a dozen.
He was held almost completely irrelevant in the first half. But what he has done since the halftime break has changed the game plan for Sioux Falls Jefferson. His ability to pass there, his second hand offensive rebound, the second chance opportunity. Makes this a one possession game.
Tally, yes, the hook and the horn. Fields just got the foul, his second. Tally to the line. What a big drive.
He is such a good player, too. You can just see the athleticism in Tally and what he can do running the floor. He's a very good defender. So confident out there, too.
Well, last week we had a whole bunch of left-handed players at the girls tournament. I think Mitchell had five in their regular rotation. Oh, nice little give and go. Sexer scores. Tally, another talented left-handed player for Mitchell.
Big fan of lefties.
We We had a ton of them last week at the girls tournament, some standout players, and probably the most left-handed shooters I've ever seen on the court at a time, especially when Mitchell was playing. Tally elevates, no. Foul, Jefferson. That's going to be on Fields, his third.
You're starting to see Fields and Tally kind of have a back and forth dialogue after every play, too. Today's top two performers for either team offensively. They've really been attacking each other on the other end of the floor as well. See how that plays out here over the final 2:21, but it has been a show today between those two top scorers.
Tally now with 20 points. Stays on 20, rebound into the hands of Sexer.
19 free throw attempts now today. Actually 20 total free throw attempts for Mitchell now.
Two-man game, Kane working down low. Sexer fakes the three, drives, his pass off target, but an offensive foul on Sexer as the defender held his ground.
That's such a hard thing to do as a defender, too, to keep your feet stationary when you know the offensive player is coming your way. Did a great job of getting out of that cylinder area, getting his feet set, his hands high, made it easy for the officials to evaluate that one. And that's one of the hardest calls for an official to make, either offensively with the charge, defensively with the blocking foul. You have a split second to make a decision there with the snapshot in your mind. And again, these officials have done a wonderful job of calling this game clean today.
Yeah, we're going to have a foul on Bohannon, and that is his third. Interesting, I heard an interview years ago with Colin Kepton, a legendary referee, and he was asked, if that's the toughest call. And interestingly, he said it wasn't the toughest call. He said it was actually the easiest call. And I think Craig Maddock was interviewing him, and he was shocked, and so was I as a listener.
I would venture to guess that he's maybe in the minority there amongst most officials, but when you're in your bag, you know what you're calling. I guess that makes it a little bit easier there, but...
You know, every referee's going to look at it differently. For some, it's an easy call. For some, it's a difficult call to make. As that free throw by Sokup is good. He's a 77% shooter on the year. Bohannon gets a break, and in comes Braylon Bear. Now, he's been on the bench a long time with those four fouls. Coming back here, minute 43 left.
Coach Reck, they used his time well. They said, okay, we're going to figure out a way to keep in this game, and then we're going to bring you in. He can't play tentative, though. He's got to go out there and play his game. If he gets his fifth foul, so be it. They need him to be out there being himself.
Unzen miscommunicates with Bear, throws it into the Jefferson bench. That's a costly turnover against the Cavaliers, and now Mitchell wants to take the timeout and discuss things. They've got the 7-point lead. It's a three-possession game. They've got the timeouts to spend, so why not make sure everybody's all together so you can execute, because you know Jefferson's going to try to make a play defensively with a steal on the inbounds.
Well, and you look at the numbers again to start this quarter. It was an 8-0 run for Sioux Falls Jefferson. They came out and looked like they were going to get themselves right back in this game. They cut it down to a one-possession game, but now Mitchell has just kind of fallen right back into their rhythm, their flow. Their fans are feeling good again here in this building. It's a 7-point lead. It's ballooned to a three-possession game. It's kind of make or break time here for this Sioux Falls Jefferson team. If they're going to get themselves back in it, it's going to have to happen here and now. You've only got 94 seconds left in this basketball game. Got to find a way to get that edge for you, getting that extra rebound, finding your open shooter at the right time. You said it, their 12th turnover of the game, maybe the most costly of this entire contest. It has been a game, I guess, early on, kind of dictated by the turnovers. Mitchell was able to build their lead while Jefferson figured things out. And then Jefferson kind of returned the favor while Mitchell was struggling with their turnover game early in the third quarter. These last 94 seconds, it's going to have to be just true grit, aggression, see who can win the battles individually out there. Jefferson, they've got the shooters to do it. This is a very tall task in front of them with the number one seeded Mitchell Colonels trying to wrap up day one with a victory here today.
Any foul by Jefferson sends the Colonels to the free throw line. They are over the limit. And they'll settle in the front court. The thing is, Jefferson, do you start fouling? Is time's ticking away, or do you try to make one defensive stand?
I think if you can get away without making the foul here over these 16 seconds, that'll leave you with about 59 seconds to try to wrap things up, but you can't give up a bucket. Got to play clean defensively.
Oh, nice play by Smith. As he scores, he's got 16. That makes it 9 points, the lead for Mitchell. As we're under a minute to go, and we're going to have a foul on Smith, and that is his third, but that's only the third team foul on Mitchell, so they could afford to give up that foul. They got one more foul to give to the Colonels. So they're really holding all the aces right now. And Jefferson really is going to need some three-pointers. Fields can't get open on the perimeter. He'll drive. Reverse layup. Too strong, but Payne is going to be fouled.
Boy, Payne would have loved to have that bucket go in along with the foul to try to make it a three-point play. Kind of looked up to the stars for a moment there, if you will, as he came back down, realizing it wasn't going to hit. Still a couple free throws with the clock stopped now. He's got a chance to get his team back within striking distance once more. The shot clock won't be turned off yet. These are big free throws.
That's good by Payne. Foul, I think, was on Tally. No, they gave it to Hinker. Hinker. That's only his second.
Keeping an eye on number 5 in white, Colton Smith. He's been grabbing that left leg pretty regularly since that scrum. When he came out of it, it looked like he may have pulled a groin or gotten some sort of like Charlie horse on the hamstring. Not sure what it is. He's been hiding it well, and anytime the referees come up and said, hey, are you okay? It's kind of shook him off right away, so he's battling through something out there right now. But 5 in white, keep an eye on him.
You're wondering, a lot of time ticking off the clock. Cavaliers, see if they're going to have to foul. Tally is playing keep away, and we got a timeout call by Mitchell. So the 7-point lead, only 28.8 seconds left. See if Jefferson maybe sends in a designated foul person.
Well, and kind of reading the lips of Coach Tim Reck there, kind of said, hey, we've got about 5 seconds left here, and then we've got to go after that basketball. We've got to start attacking. They were trying to get Mitchell to make a mistake in the pass, trying to get them to step over the line out of bounds. Nothing ever really worked for them there, so now it's time to kind of kick it up a notch, see if they can't find a way to get that turnover, force it, if nothing else, send them to the free throw line, and then you take your chances. But how good of a free throw shooting team Mitchell is and has been all season long, that's maybe the last risk they want to take. They want to find a way to get the turnover here, try to turn it into a transition bucket, and then fight for the next possession. But this is kind of your back against the wall time now for Sioux Falls Jefferson. If you can get a stop here, it's still game on. Mitchell comes away with any points in this possession. Makes the task very difficult for Jefferson to get back in this game.
I think you're right. Any play by Jefferson has to happen within 5 seconds. Then you got to commit the foul. It'll be Solik to trigger it in at side court. They get it into Tally. He's one of their top free throw shooters. The other one there is Sokup, and he's going to be fouled.
That's right about where they needed to. That was 4 seconds off the clock, committed the foul. Really don't want to have either one of these guys going to the line, Tally or Sokup, but I think Sokup maybe is a slightly better option if you're Jefferson. He's a very good free throw shooter, but percentage is maybe just a little bit lower than where Tally was, so foul the guy percentage-wise and see how it goes.
Sokup missed it. He's 77% on the year. He's actually the top shooter for Mitchell at the free throw line this year. Now we'll have the offense for defense substitution for Jefferson, and here comes Mandel in. Give Hinker a break. So a little quicker lineup out there for Mitchell. You got to figure they want to guard the perimeter, guard that 3-point line. They'll give up an easy bucket underneath. That doesn't hurt them so bad. The three is what you got to worry about if you're Mitchell. And that free throw is good. 14 on the afternoon for Soka. Fields. He's going to launch a three. No. Long rebound. Unson got tied up with Solik, and it goes out of bounds to Mitchell with just 17.4 seconds left. That may be all she wrote for this one. Mitchell's just got to get the ball in play, and there's the quick foul on Fields. And he might have jammed a finger.
He's now the fourth Jefferson player to pick up his fourth foul. They haven't had any of these guys foul out today, but they've had to basically drain everything out of this defense to try to hang in this game and give Jefferson a lot of credit. The eight seed, they were down by double digits. I believe it ballooned out to a 15-point lead at one point in this game. They came back and made it a two-point contest early on in the fourth quarter, and it looked for all the world like they may have an upset built in them today. There's a lot of talented basketball players on the floor in our first matchup of this tournament. This Mitchell team proving that they have earned that number one seed.
Yep, they weathered that big storm in the early fourth quarter. And it looks like they will prevail. So they're up by 10 with just a few seconds left. And there's a shot up and in by Braylon Bear. That's his first points of the afternoon. Tally is going to get it, and he'll just dribble it out. And your final score will be 69-61. Mitchell advances to the semifinals tomorrow night with a hard-fought win against Sioux Falls Jefferson in our first matchup. We'll take a break, come back, and have highlights and stats from this game. More in a moment here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
I decided to switch my major. I didn't want to do sports anymore, so I decided Southeast Tech would be a good one for me to go. The current instructor is a captain with the Highway Patrol. He had a lot of experience and knowledge about the job. I serve the people just as much as they serve me.
The way humans make sense of the world is through stories.
We've got to go ahead and start training to go to Mars.
And lift off.
We pay tribute to all who serve and who have served.
Civilization is precious. Life is precious.
Artists here are making a difference.
I'm trying to seek redemption.
Welcome back here to the Sanford Premier Center in Sioux Falls. Our first game of the day went right down to the wire, but Mitchell holds off Jefferson 69-61, the final score. Jefferson outscored Mitchell 18-16 in that fourth quarter. It was down to a two-point game after Mitchell led by 10 going into that final stanza. But I think you said it, JJ, Mitchell weathered that storm. You know, everyone's got a rally in them. Everyone's going to make a run in AA basketball. And Mitchell, with some solid play in the fourth quarter, managed to prevail. Let's check out some of the highlights here from the second half.
Really, when you look at everything, just one lead change in this game. Mitchell did dominate this game. Really, from about the first 2 minutes on, Jefferson had the early 4-0 lead, got some point production early. Mitchell was struggling to score, and the Jefferson scorers, they were finding their rhythm. And then all of a sudden, Mitchell Colonel started to kind of take over in this game. Even so, you could see this Jefferson team didn't really have a quit in them, didn't give up in their pursuit of a return into this basketball game. And you can see Damaris Fields, what he meant to his team today. 16 points. And when he started scoring, it kind of became infectious. I think that one-handed jam there from Hinker kind of was the exclamation point in this game. Turned it around for good for Mitchell. The effort was there from Jefferson. And just in all, too much Mitchell. Too many free throws in the first half for Mitchell. They ended up shooting 14 more free throws than Jefferson did in this game. Hit 19 of 26 today. It's an impressive total at the free throw line. If you're getting to the line that many times at the state tournament level, you're probably going to be winning a lot of games over a three-day stretch.
Jefferson did narrow that rebounding disadvantage, and when they started to get more rebounds there in that fourth quarter, that's when their rally happened, but it came up just a little bit short. Turnovers ended up relatively even on the day. Four players in double figures for both squads. Marcus with 22. Marcus Talley, 22 for Mitchell, leading the way. Smith with 16. Soka, 14. Hinker with 12. Meanwhile, for Jefferson, it was Fields with 16 points. It was 14 for Payne, 13 for Sexer, 10 for Bohannon. The top scorers for Sioux Falls Jefferson, as they will play in our first consolation game tomorrow afternoon. Mitchell plays on semifinal Friday night. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back. We'll have more from the AA Boys Basketball Tournament after this break on SDPB 3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Oh my goodness.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Welcome back to the AA Boys State Basketball Tournament inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. We get you set for game number two. Before we do that, we want to take a look at the living dream. It's an impossible task, Steve, to talk about inspiring people without talking about those who inspire our kids, the coaches in particular in this situation. Ruth Dreamer took a job this season with the Ulrichs Boys basketball team. Along with getting her feet wet in her new home, she's also helping lay the foundation of new traditions with the Tiger squad.
Basketball is life to me. I grew up watching it before I actually got to play the game. So I think that's where the interest and the love for it grew. I just got to be around it.
Ruth Dreamer has had a strong love for basketball. This year, she took a new job as the boys' basketball coach for Ulrichs High School.
This number calls me and they're like, hey, are you coaching anywhere? And I'm like, no. And they're like, well, we need a coach. I'm like, where at? And they're like, Ulrichs boys varsity. I'm like, really? And they're like, yeah, if you're down. I'm like, yeah, sure, let me come in. You know, did the interview the next day, got hired. And it was It was definitely a challenge, because like I said, I didn't ever think I would. But it's exciting and it's fun. I really, really like it, especially with this group of boys. They're really eager to learn. So it's just been really, really an amazing experience.
Ruth grew up in Pine Ridge, where she became a standout player for the Lady Thorps.
I actually had 1,800 points in my high school career. So the first thought people asked me was, well, when did I start playing in high school? And they actually asked me as a seventh grader to play, but I never wanted to. I always thought I was way too small. So I wanted to stay in middle school until I graduated eighth grade. But back then I played the first two quarters for my freshman team. So they're like, okay, we're gonna save you for JV. So then I played two quarters on JV. And they're like, okay, we're gonna save you for varsity. So I played two quarters on varsity. And then from that day on, I never played freshman or JV again. I became a starter for varsity for the rest of my career.
Ruth is focused on creating something special at her new home.
I guess it just shifted more or less to the program that I want to build here.
As long as you keep dribbling, he's going to get out of the way because you're bigger, but when you extend that arm, then it's offensive.
You know, and keep like Oryx is a great school. They have Wilding, they have Woods. We're actually getting a new weight room built. Like I said, this gym's only 2 years old, this whole school actually. So it's just exciting because I think that's where like my mindset shifted, where I'm not like worried about my position as much as I am about like, what do you call it? Like the recreation of this school, like the foundation of it, you know? Like I really, really want to start and end my career here. Like this is the program I want to build.
It's a great opportunity. She pushes me to be the best that I can and every day I practice. She doesn't force anything on me and it just helps me love the game even more, you know? She just pushes me to be a better person every day and I appreciate her for that. My first thought when I heard that a female coach was going to be our coach was I thought she wasn't going to be able to coach us because she's a girl and this is a man's sport. But after the first day of practice, she showed me that she has a lot more to offer than other coaches in the past year. And she knows a lot more than boys, you know, I could tell you that. She's a very vocal coach, but if you do something wrong, she ain't going to get on your butt about it and tell you that you're doing something wrong. She's going to teach you to stop doing that and make it a good habit rather than a bad habit. She taught me to eat right, healthy, treat your body just as, you know, you would. Don't put toxic things in it, like smoking, drinking, alcohol, and that stuff, you know.
Along with helping players be successful on and off the court, Ruth hopes she can also be a role model for future females in the state.
Honestly, I would say just, you know, stick with your goals and dreams. You know, like I said, I didn't think I'd be coaching a boys team, but I love it. It's exciting. It's a new challenge, and I'm always up for a new challenge. But, you know, just take your time and be patient, you know, because I almost was like I said, I was just going to sit back and not coach anywhere, you know, and I answered that call or whatever. But just, I would just say take your time and just stay focused because you never know when your opportunity is going to present itself.
SDPB recently produced a program entitled Tales from the Hardwood, which featured Ruth's stories and others. You can go to sdpb.org/basketball and watch Tales from the Hardwood today. We will take another time out. When we come back, we'll get you set up for our second matchup in our afternoon session. We'll be back with more AA Boys Basketball on SDPB.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship, because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders. Tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain. Followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
Welcome back inside the Dennis Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Class AA boys state basketball here on SDPB Sports. We've already got one game in the books. It was a lot closer than I think the Mitchell Colonels would have liked, but they held on for the 69-61 win. Now we get ready for quarterfinal game number two. That will decide who Mitchell plays tomorrow night at 6 p.m. We've got a good matchup. This is probably the most even matchup of the tournament. The 4-5 ranking obviously showcases these two teams' abilities. We've got two Sioux Falls schools ready to duke it out. Sioux Falls, Washington. The Warriors, led by head coach Jeff Tobin, coming into today's action as the 5 seed. They will wear their road blacks today, and you can see how they've gotten here, riding wins over their last 4 games, Steve. And it has been low-scoring affairs, but they've found ways against some really good opponents, including 3 that have found their way here to this state tournament.
Yeah, Washington is actually number 4 in the final poll, but because of power points, they're number 5 seed. They beat Roosevelt late in the year, 56-52. Lost to him at the Pentagon early on, 71-49. As you look at their starting lineup here, Thomas Hoffman, Samuel Baskett, Lucas Johnson, Brennan Verhey, and Jace Woods. Their top scorer is Hoffman at a little over 13.5 points per game. Lubab Kambalo comes off the bench, gives him nearly 9 points a game. He is a speedy guard, a 5'7 senior. And then Mitch Begeman leads the Roosevelt Rough Riders.
Yeah, these Roosevelt Rough Riders are coming in having won their last 3 games. Actually, before that, had won, lost 3 of their last 4, but have found their winning ways again after victories over Aberdeen Central, here TF Riggs, and then again faced Aberdeen Central in the SODAC 16 to advance to the tournament. They've had some high-scoring games throughout the season, but they're another team that likes to keep it in the mid-50s as far as point totals are concerned. We are expecting this to be a tight matchup here today, Steve, and really two very talented teams out of Sioux Falls ready to entertain their home crowd.
Yeah, we'll take a look at their starters here, and they'll be introduced in a moment by our public address announcer, Greg Thompson.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association, along with its corporate partners, Sanford Health, Dakota Bank, Farmers Union Insurance, Billion Automotive, Agtigra Cooperative, ABC Rentals, The Furniture Mart, South Dakota Highway Patrol, Lake Area Tech, Masaba, Experience Sioux Falls, and the South Dakota Army National Guard welcome you to this opening game of the State Boys AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activity Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Let's first meet the cheer teams for both squads. First, for the Warriors of Washington, Aubrey Chavez, Angelina Fuentes, Emma Halstein, Tia Jensen, Tania Jensen, Abigail Johnson, Maya Kuzman, Annalisa Steele. Their coaches, Bailey Franson and Cindy Jones. Now let's meet the cheer team for the Rough Riders of Roosevelt. Destiny Andrews, Journey Vaughn, Addison Fox, Bailey Langford Boone, Jada Beckham, Lily Fentigal, Rachel Johnson, and Tristan Dam. Their coaches, Haley Robinson and Hannah Molitor. And now, let's meet the starting lineups in alternating fashion. For the Warriors, at guard at 6'1", junior number 3, Samuel Baskin. For the Rough Riders, at guard at 5'8", senior number 2, Nasser Ismail. For the Warriors, at guard at 6'2", junior number 4, Thomas Hoffman. For the Rough Riders, at guard at 6', senior number 3, Hayden Goff. For the Warriors, at guard at 6'1", junior number 10, Brennan Verhey. For the Rough Riders, at guard at 6'2", senior number 4, Logan Nielsen. For the Warriors, at forward at 6'6", junior number 14, Lucas Johnson. For the Rough Riders, at forward at 6'3", junior number 13, Isaiah Garan. And for the Warriors, at guard at 6'3", sophomore number 22, Jake Woods. For the Rough Riders, at center, 6'5", junior number 20, Akeem Moko. The Warriors are led by Jeff Tobin, assistant coaches Mike Halstein, J.J. Hayden, Will Hanneman, and Tyson Thies. The Rough Riders are led by Mitch Begeman, assistant coaches Luke Hanneman, Trey Walter, and Jordan Waltman. Your officials for this game, Chad DeYoung, Andy Deinert, and Jeff Hafner.
1, 2, 3, let's go! We are ready for tip-off. Game 2 of our quarterfinal matchup. We'll have 2 more coming your way tonight, but this our second game of the afternoon session. Our 4-5 matchup. Sioux Falls teams who know each other all too well. I'm JJ Hartigan, he's Steve Toome. We are ready for AA boys basketball. Steve, your final thoughts.
Yeah, last year it was Roosevelt over Washington for 7th place. Let's see how these teams come out man-to-man early on for the Rough Riders.
The Warriors are wearing their road blacks today with the orange letters, numbers, and white trim. Roosevelt comes out donned in their home whites with the yellow numbers and the maroon trim. We are ready with the first miss of the day. Washington on their first possession comes up empty now. It'll be this Roosevelt team as they circle things around.
Roosevelt, good balanced attack on offense. Ismail at 11 points per game, one of their top scorers.
Get that one to go. Both teams empty on their first possessions of the day. Now Washington on the attack, going inside, and that one laid off the glass. And Brennan Verhey, the 6'1 junior, plays both the guard and forward positions. A versatile player, gets on the board first for the Warriors.
Yeah, he averages 4 points, 5.5 rebounds per game. Again, balanced attack, that's the trademark for both of these schools.
Nice drive inside. That one hung on the rim. Some contact going back up. No whistle. Moko thought there should have been a foul on the play there.
Yeah, good offensive board by Moko. Just couldn't quite get it to fall. And I think the pivot foot slipped there. Yes, it did, by Hoffman. 13.7 points, 5.5 rebounds per game for Hoffman, a 6'2 junior. A lot of juniors and sophomores in the lineup for Washington. And a few more seniors in the lineup for Roosevelt. Both these teams pretty young, and there's a turnover.
Taking care of the basketball is going to be a big part of it. We saw 22 turnovers in the first game of this tournament in our 1-8 matchup. The importance of taking good care of the basketball, that's always in the back of the mind of Mitch Begeman. Comes from a great basketball family. He's taken over this program and taken them to great heights. This has been at times a struggle this year with getting some of these young players acclimated into the system. We mentioned late in January, early February, lost 3 of 4, but have come into this tournament on a 3-game winning streak. These Warriors are going to the line now for the first time today. Lucas Johnson went in strong. He should have a pair of free throws coming up.
Yep, that was Nielsen. Lucas Johnson. He averages 9.3 points, 3.8 rebounds per game, 63% shooter on the season from the free throw line.
Crowd on hand here inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. We expect the crowds to grow as the night goes on and throughout the weekend.
Jackson Brower, number 23, 6'4 senior, checking in for Roosevelt. He provides a lot of scoring punch off the bench at over 6 points per game.
They're not afraid to go to their bench early in this one to try to avoid foul trouble, but having that depth coming off the bench is a great asset for this Roosevelt team. See how they get him involved early on, and they will early here. That three, no, from the left corner doesn't connect.
Both of these teams not shy about launching it up from long range.
The Warriors want to settle things down a little bit. Rough Riders.
Trying for a backdoor cut there, but it wasn't open.
Very good defensive team. You mentioned both teams like to keep the point totals in the low 50s. Very rare that they get up above 60, either they or their opponents on the floor.
Oh, a hook shot there by Baskin in that last attempt by Washington.
Got that tipped, but impatience for these Rough Riders. 3-point attempt too strong, an offensive rebound there. Nice drive in, ball ejected, not once but twice. A pair of defenders in there to deny the entry. Take a look again. Found a little seam in the defense.
Two defenders there. I think that was Woods who got his hand on the ball for Washington. Both these defenses very quick. They'll have to shut down the paint because players like that are going to drive.
Washington is out to an early 6-0 lead. They're trying to build as they get the ball across the half court line now with under 5 minutes to go in this opening quarter. Coach Begeman and his Rough Riders back on the defensive side of things.
Nice move there by Lucas Johnson.
Johnson, his first attempt from the field today, got his first points at the line. He's already added in a pair of rebounds and an assist in 3 minutes. Good start to his state tournament.
Yeah, 0-7 so far from Roosevelt. Not a way you want to start the game.
The Riders trying to get it inside. They've looked multiple times at Moko as he posted up. Now he goes to work and gets fouled. I think Thomas Hoffman wanted a clean block there, but the officials saw it differently. That should be us to our media timeout. 4:19 left to go in this opening quarter. Washington leading 8-0. Roosevelt will be at the line when we come back. More AA basketball coming your way from Sioux Falls in just a moment.
Dreamer. Doer. Difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Here in Sioux Falls, you see the Roosevelt fans eager for their first points of this contest, and they go up to the free throw line now, looking for those first points of the day. Akeem Moko, the 6'5 junior.
Yep, 53% on the year. He averages 4.5 points, just shy of 3.5 rebounds per game. Washington made their last three field goals. They're 3-4, 0-7 for Roosevelt to start the game. Missed them both. The thing about Coach Begeman, with the way he coaches this team, he's not going to get rattled if his team falls behind. He knows this may not a team that has much scoring punch as other teams in the past, but they can still put points on the board.
got tipped out of bounds. Nifty ball handling inside the lane that time. Didn't come away with anything. Thomas Hoffman will trigger this from the baseline. But you're right. What this coaching staff, Mitch Begeman and his crew over there with Luke Hanneman, his assistant, the way they run things, this 8-0 deficit isn't all that to be concerned about. But if Washington starts hitting their threes like that, look out. It's now an 11-0 run to start the day here in our 4-5 matchup.
Nice pass underneath, and oh, the shot no good there by Taden Nave. Boy, they had a nice setup on that play, just could not finish.
3:37 left to go now in this opening quarter. That off the fingertips and out of bounds. Baskin had his hand on it there for a moment, but the 6'1 junior couldn't receive it cleanly. It'll be Rough Rider basketball now in search of their first points.
Yeah, Nave signed to play football at Northern. He's handling the rock right now.
Wide open look here from the top of the key. That's no good. Tipped out, but into the hands this time. Baskin, who secures it with two hands, and gets it out into the front court. Some contact on the way up, and a blocking foul will send Lucas Johnson back to the free throw line. First personal of the day will be called on Jackson Brower. His first.
Brower, a senior at 6'4".
Junior Johnson puts in his third free throw attempt of the day. He'll be granted one more here.
A great start for Washington. Can't ask for much better than this. They're playing lights out defense as Roosevelt's 0-9 from the floor to start the game.
Meanwhile, Washington's efficiency sky high right now, 4-5 from the field, but a foul called here. Verhey had the only other foul for Washington. This will be on Woods, second team foul on Washington. At the free throw line, Nasser Ishmael, the 5'8 senior guard, puts in the first points of the day for Sioux Falls Roosevelt.
Yeah, it took him nearly 5 minutes to score. He's a 70% shooter on the year, is Ishmael, averaging 11 points per game. Another lefty.
They're everywhere now, look out.
Desperately needed points there for Roosevelt, just psychologically to get that goose egg off the scoreboard. Jamari Tiger in the game, number 24 for Roosevelt. He's an interesting story. Lived in four different countries already.
Amazing life that's brought him here to South Dakota to play basketball here this weekend. This Washington team missed their first shot of the day, but now have hit four straight. This is going to be a foul on the attempt, and it sends us back to the free throw line. This will be Jace Woods, the sophomore, 6'3 guard. It's this one up and in.
Nave got that last foul.
Fouls are something we're going to have to keep an eye on. It's been okay so far. Three players for Roosevelt each have one to this point. Two players have committed a foul for Washington. Nobody's picked up their second as of yet. 2:44 left to go now in this opening quarter of action. Ishmael bouncing it inside. They'll swing it out and around. That got tipped. Out of bounds right in front of our location. Here's Hoffman tried to track it down.
I love the intensity the Warriors are playing defense with. They've got a good spring in their step defensively to start this contest.
15-2 advantage. It's 13-0 before we had any points on the board for Roosevelt. Ishmael inside, swings it out to the left corner. The three off the backside of the iron. That's no good. He wants another one. This one from the top of the key is good. Nasher Ishmael, the 5'8 guard, hits the first bucket from the field today for Sioux Falls Roosevelt.
He is a spark plug for the Rough Riders, and they desperately needed that tray.
0-10 before that one went in from the field. 0-5 from three-point land now. 1-6 from three, 1-11 from the field overall. Trying to get a stop here defensively. That one through the fingertips. They do get their stop. Brower into the front court. He'll slow things up with just over 90 seconds left in this opening quarter.
Well, I think Ishmael thought about the three there, decided to keep the play alive.
Dribble with the left hand, now crossing over inside, drawing contact all the way in. They're going to say the foul on the ground. Basket will not count. They do get Washington's Thomas Hoffman with the personal foul.
Now, Roosevelt's had an interesting year. They've lost a couple of games to Jefferson by combined 5 points.
Finger roll finish is good for the lefty. He's taken this game into his own hands here over the last couple minutes. Ishmael now with 5 points on the day, actually 7 points.
And he's got all the points for the Rough Riders.
Minute five left to go. They go back to work defensively. Washington trying to push this lead back out. Sitting at an 8-point advantage with a minute to go in our opening quarter.
Tried a little pick and roll there.
Floater no good. The offensive rebound doesn't go in, and now a foul at the tail end of that play. Rough Riders are going to be disappointed with this one. It's going to go against Roosevelt.
Looks like Jackson Brower just got his second foul.
Chase back at the line. He misses his first.
67% on the year for the sophomore.
Chase Woods hit his first two free throw attempts of the day. Hasn't taken a shot from the field yet, though. Does have 2 points, two rebounds. He's also blocked a shot in the opening 7 minutes. Comes up empty here. 0 for 2 on this trip. 50 seconds to go in the quarter, and it's still an 8-point game.
Elijah Johnson handling the rock there. He just checked in, number 5.
All around to the left side. A lot of contact as they tried to force it inside that time to Tiger. That one blocked out of bounds. Hand on at that time for Lucas Johnson. It'll leave 11 on the shot clock. 29 seconds left to go in this opening quarter.
Yeah, Logan Nielsen got stuffed on that particular play. Now Woods is going to get a break for Washington.
Inbound coming from the baseline. They go left side. The three on the way. Rattles in and out. No good. The tip out after the offensive rebound. That one's no good. Got tipped out of bounds. Last touch by...
That was Taden Nave.
Yeah, Roosevelt had a couple guys down there. Taden Nave, the senior, 6'3", presence inside.
Yeah, his brother Tyree played on those back-to-back championship teams.
Shot clock turned off now, down to the final 10 seconds. Quarter number one in this 4-versus-5 matchup. That one gets taken away.
Oh, he lost the handle.
The carry there as he worked his way in. Yeah, Logan Nielsen, the 6'2 senior. Had an open lane for the hoop, but lost track of the basketball.
They'll launch it.
Three quarters length is no good. That's how your first quarter comes to an end. 15-7 at the end of quarter number one. Head into quarter number two. Take a look at some of these numbers when we come back. More from the AA Boys Basketball Tournament when we return.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other. Lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Inside the Sanford Pentagon, heading into quarter, the Denny Sanford Premier Center as we head into quarter number two from our Class AA Boys State Tournament. The girls tournament was at the Pentagon last week. We move across down to the Denny Sanford Premier Center here for this one. It's been exciting already. The number 8 seed, Sioux Falls Jefferson, gave number 1 seeded Mitchell a run for their money. Number 1 ends up winning that game. Mitchell advances to tomorrow night. Now waiting to find out who they play. It'll be one of these two, four versus five. Roosevelt, the four seed, struggling offensively in that opening quarter and now turning the ball over to start the second quarter. Washington just continues to hit. That young man's having a good start to his day. Hoffman left the hand up there for a moment for good measure as he pushes it back to an 11-point lead.
Yeah, 5 of 7 now for Washington from the floor. Meanwhile, 2 of 15 for Roosevelt. And they're just going to have to just whittle away at this big lead, but they need to find somebody on offense. That shot's off the mark.
7 points for Roosevelt so far. 2 of that has come at the free throw line, but really the offensive struggles have been all over the place.
Yeah, here's the interesting thing. Washington's had all their starters score,
and
only one player so far has scored for Roosevelt, and that's Nasser Ismail. I'm more worried about saving the equipment. I think that's, obviously. I think the powers that be, it's like, save the equipment, Steve. You, not so much.
Steve is a consummate professional over here. He literally caught that basketball while taking care of stats in his stat book, explaining everything that's going on the court to you guys. Nobody better in the business right here. My partner locked in day one.
Oh, it's that time of year, man. You got to be locked in. Where else would you rather be than at a basketball tournament?
Probably could have had a foul there. Nothing on the whistle. They let it go, and Ismail hits again. He has literally been the lifeboat for this team here so far today. Every point that's been scored for Roosevelt has come off his fingertips so far.
Yeah, all the starters have scored for Washington, just one player from Roosevelt. And here's a bomb from outside.
That's kept alive for a moment. They'll say, yeah, he was towing the baseline. It goes out of bounds. Roosevelt do a little subbing here. They're going to bring in Logan Nielsen off the bench. Nielsen, a 6'2 senior. He'll inbound this one for Roosevelt as they try to claw back into this one. It's a 9-point game, and by no means is this game out of reach. It's going to be a low-scoring defensive battle.
Oh, another missed three.
Offensive rebound's a big one there. Roosevelt just continues to chuck him up, hoping one will hit. That doesn't go. It's not as if they're bad shots right now, though, Steve.
No,
these are good
looks.
They're just not hitting.
Now it's Jamari Tiger there with a couple of shots, and he averages 7 points per game. That one's going to stay with Washington, and he's a guy that shoots 43% from beyond the arc. I mean, that's his shot, and he's getting open looks. They're just not falling. That's the young man started actually playing basketball, I believe, in Israel. He's lived in Greece, Hungary, and the United States, so he's been all over the world.
It's just incredible. That's a long-range three, no good. Put this into perspective for you, Roosevelt. This would be their, that gets swatted out of bounds. I was about to say that shot would have been their 20th shot already in this game. They've taken 19 official attempts from the field, only 8 for Washington. So they've more than doubled the amount of shots that their opponent has taken today. Eventually, they're going to start falling. Right now, Roosevelt is really having a tough time finding that rhythm.
Yeah, Roosevelt, 3 of 20 now from the floor. That is not a good percentage.
Washington in a little bit of a scoring drought right now, though. They haven't scored a bucket in 2 minutes. That 3, no, off the backside of the iron. It remains a 9-point game.
And, yeah, I think if you're Coach Begum, you just want to find somebody, anybody besides Ismail, that can throw it in. You got to find a combination that works out there that can set up other players.
Fans have been involved in this game despite the lack of scoring.
Oh,
nice finger roll finish there off the dribble drive for Lucas Johnson. Such a versatile player, up to 8 points now on the day.
And just everybody contributing so far for the Warriors.
Tough defense from Washington, did not allow that pass to come in easily. Now Ismail kicks it out. Right back to him, and a traveling violation. Give Washington the ball as we head to our media timeout. 4:15 left to go in our first half. It's been all Warriors so far. 20-9 your score here in Sioux Falls.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth. And they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
Back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Your site of AA boys basketball here for the next 3 days on SDPB. So far, Roosevelt struggling, Stephen. Those numbers just really been hard to look at here so far.
Yeah, 3 of 21 from the floor for 8% and 1 of 12 from beyond the arc for Roosevelt.
Washington has been willing to shoot from just about anywhere, but their shot selections have been much more limited. That was just their 10th shot attempt, actually their 11th shot attempt of the day. They're 6 of 11 from the field.
Yeah, 2 of 7 from beyond the arc for Washington. But they have been just very steady, getting contributions from everybody on the floor.
Another drive inside, no offensive rebound. The putback, no. That got punched in the air and brought back down by Washington. That into the front court. Pinballing around. Finally, the Warriors come away with it. The three, no. Offensive rebound pulled down, though. Another opportunity there, no. And I think they may have gotten Johnson with the defensive, rather offensive foul that time. It's going to be Roosevelt basketball.
Yes, first foul on Johnson, fighting hard. And good ball movement there, good chase down, and then instead of trying to force something, the pass was made to the outside and the quick release there, shot didn't fall, but good battling inside by Lucas Johnson, just couldn't get that one to fall on the stick back attempt.
Roosevelt, they look for a much needed three, that doesn't go. Their offensive struggles. Ooh, and a turnover, traveling violation is going to give Roosevelt the ball back with 3 minutes to go. But you look at the numbers and you say, okay, well, eventually Roosevelt's going to get back in this one. Washington's going to go on a little bit of a drought. They're in a drought right now. They haven't scored in almost 3.5 minutes. They're 0 for their last 7 from the field. Roosevelt just can't find a way to start chipping away at that 11-point difference.
Yeah, the opportunity's here for him. I mean, you know, when the other team stops scoring, is that one's going to be out of bounds, some contact there. And that was Hayden Goff who just lost it out of bounds. And, you know, like I said, the opportunity is there for Roosevelt. They're just not walking through the door.
Look at some of the defensive numbers, turnovers. Washington has forced 5 turnovers already. There have been 3 blocked shots by Warrior defenders. Now you see Roosevelt on the other end, Steve, starting to maybe showcase their defense a little bit. That's going to be a charge. Nice job there underneath that time by Nave to get in front of the offensive player and get his feet set.
Yeah, it was Lubab Kumbalo with the charge there. First foul on the senior for Washington.
Still an 11-point game, though. Roosevelt going to work. 3 on the way from the top of the key, well off the mark. This one picked up a one-and-done opportunity. Roosevelt now 3 of 25 from the field here in this first half. Just 1 of 14 from three-point land.
Yeah, they're bombing it up from long range. That's part of their game. The shots just not falling here at all. Meanwhile, Washington much more efficient. But another miss there for Washington. They're in a bit of a scoring drought.
That's 9 straight shots. Both teams have had scoreless droughts now of 2.5 minutes or more. Roosevelt's on a 4-minute, 15-second scoreless drought. Washington, 2.5 minutes. They've hit just 1 of their last 7 shots. Roosevelt's hit just 1 of their last 8. Actually, over their last 8 as I double-check my math.
But yeah. Boy, that's it. Both teams really struggling.
That one, no, doesn't go on the roll. Had a chance inside. It's not just as if the three-point shots aren't falling. Even the close ones, the high-percentage shots have been difficult here today.
And that was actually another decent look for Roosevelt. I mean, they're getting the opportunities, just nothing falling for them at all.
aside from Ishmael, who's 3 of 10 from the field, the rest of the team is 0 for 16.
Two free throws coming up here, and I think that Ishmael is going to get tagged for that foul. And he will. It's only his first. As Baskin at 6'1 just took the smaller player, Ishmael at 5'8, right to the rack.
This one off the front side of the iron, no good. It remains 20-9 in what has been a very fast-paced first half of basketball. Haven't been a lot of fouls to talk about on this one. There have been plenty of offensive opportunities here today. Washington has taken the advantage in that one now, 21-9. Just over 90 seconds left to go in our first half.
3 of 26 for Roosevelt from the floor. That is only 7%. There's all they needed.
Much needed three there. Durang laid it in.
If Isaiah averages 5.5 points, 2.5 rebounds per game, he's a junior, and boy, they needed that shot in the worst way. Still plenty of time for Roosevelt to cut into this lead and get it within a couple of possessions. But, you know, they just need to find somebody, anybody besides Ishmael, who can put it in the hole.
Washington, a 3-minute scoreless drought.
Yeah, it's just, you know, like I said, the opportunity is there for the Rough Riders to get back into it. Hey, don't forget, your passport to great programming is available online. With SDPB Passport, you can access hundreds of hours of programs you can't see anywhere else. Your gift of only $5 a month grants you access to shows from Masterpiece to the entire collection of Ken Burns documentaries and a whole lot more. You can make a gift and get started today. More at sdpb.org/passport.
I do like that Finding Your Roots show. That's a pretty cool one, too. There, that shot shot in after the turnover. Boy, this Washington team already with 4 blocks in this first half. They have been real sound on the defensive end.
Nice angle taken there by Baskin to block that one. And that kind of maybe encapsulates the first half here so far for Wash or for Roosevelt.
Ishmael inside. He's had 11 points now on the day. Continues to be that steady hand offensively. His fourth make from the field. He's added in 3 rebounds in 14 minutes.
Roosevelt cranking up the pressure. They're going to go man-to-man in the half court. They try to get a trap.
Coach Begeman with his energy, his enthusiasm on the sideline, trying to will his guys back into this game. Good defense here from the Rough Riders.
Well, it's going to start with defense. Any comeback starts with defense.
Trying to get a stop. First thing that could happen would be a foul. Oh, and there's a travel. They're going to get the travel before the shot clock. No, it's a shot clock violation. And losing his footing on the way in and slipping underneath the hoop was Jace Woods that time. He had a chance to try to get the shot before the buzzer sounded, Steve, but the sneakers got a little slippery there.
Yeah, and great defense by Roosevelt. Now, they have an opportunity for the final shot. They could cut this to a 5, maybe even a 4-point game.
You can make this 2 possessions by halftime. That's a huge step in the right direction for Roosevelt. This has been a half of basketball to forget if you're a Rough Riders fan. They're shooting just 17%. One man has scored 11 of their 14 points today. That's number 2 in white. He'll hand it off. The 3, no. Off the front side of the iron, no good. The shot waved off. Hits the backboard, but it wouldn't have counted. That is how this first half comes to an end. 21-14 in a low-scoring affair. Roosevelt's got some things to work on offensively heading into the locker room. Really, both teams do. We'll talk about those numbers when we come back. More AA boys basketball will return from Sioux Falls after the break.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship, because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
This is the PBS app. It's ready for you whenever you want full episodes of your favorites. Perhaps a little history or the real story. Shows with heart or the latest news and docs. Even stream your local station live. It's all there waiting for you. So download the PBS app now for everything you love and a whole lot more to explore. Stream anytime, anywhere with the PBS app.
Welcome back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. 21-14 is your score at the halftime break. Washington with the 7-point lead. It was much bigger than that, though, Steve, at the halftime break. And we would expect a much closer game in the second half, but really, the Warriors won the first two quarters of this contest.
Yeah, they played much better. Their largest lead was 13 at one point as they got off to a great start there with Baskin. And just defense by Washington and just missed shots. As you see Lucas Johnson there with the nice drive. And then the outside shot there, that's Hoffman scoring. And just not many shots falling. The only offense has really been Nasser Ismail, as he has all but three of their points. Meanwhile, it's been a balanced attack for Washington. All five of their starters. And here's some more great defense by Baskin after the steal. And if you like high scoring, you know, guys shooting lights out, you know, Steph Curry like shots, this is not your game, folks. Roosevelt is 5 of 30 from the floor for 17%. And they are just 2 of 16 from 3-point land, good for 13%. Washington's been much more efficient, 43% from the floor. They've also gotten to the free throw line more times. Rebounding is pretty even. 4 more turnovers for Washington compared to Roosevelt, but that was about a roughest shooting half as you're ever going to see at the AA level for high school boys basketball. Roosevelt, in some ways, is maybe even lucky to be down by just 7 points here, because Washington, you called it, JJ, they had a scoring slump of their own in that second quarter.
Yeah, it went almost 3.5 minutes before they got another point on the board. Really, there have been 3 scorers in this game. Ishmael with his 11 points for Roosevelt. Johnson was just 2 of 5 from the field in the first half for Washington, but was 4 for 4 at the free throw line. That got him up to 8 points, 7 rebounds at the intermission. A pretty good stat line when it's all said and done. And then Hoffman, the only other real scorer in this game, again for Washington with 6 points, but he's 2 of 6 from the field. So really the shooting struggles are on both ends of the floor today when you look at things. It's gonna have to be somebody else who steps up in the second half, and you gotta figure that this Roosevelt shooting struggle just won't continue much longer. Feeling the final two quarters are going to be much more exciting than they were over the first two. We've still got a few minutes here until halftime. As they regroup, recover, get reset, we'll take a quick timeout, do the same thing, and get you geared up for the third quarter of action coming up next here on SDPB.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Oh my goodness.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther, going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring, keep making memories, keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Washington ahead of Roosevelt here at the break, 21-14. Class AA boys basketball here. You know, the town of Oneida is no stranger to rich sports history here in South Dakota, especially with basketball. In October of 2022, longtime girls basketball coach Mark Sefner passed away during a battle with cancer. This season, Sully Buttes High School officially dedicated its court to honor the legacy of Coach Sefner.
On December 21st of 2023, Sully Buttes held a ceremony to officially dedicate the court in honor of Mark Sefner.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a large round of applause as we officially dedicate this court in honor of Coach Mark Sefner.
It meant a lot, especially me and my mom. Knowing this day has been coming, we had it circled on the calendar, and then to see people that came here or from near and far. It was a pretty cool deal to see everyone.
It says so much about where we live and why we choose to live here, because we might get a little owly with each other, but this is a pretty special place to live, not just in Oneida, but in the Midwest, South Dakota especially. Yeah, we had tons of support. They let Scott and I come in and make the first baskets on the court. And I was 2 for 4, and yes, mine were layups. Scott probably made all 4 of his. But that meant a lot that they wanted to include us in that.
They back us and give us 100% support throughout the season. And I was really proud and honored.
SDPB recently produced a program entitled Tales from the Hardwood, which featured Mark's story and others. To watch the full version of Mark Sefner's court dedication, go to sdpb.org/basketball and watch Tales from the Hardwood today. Of course, that's not the only coach that we are in mourning of. Brandon Valley, that community, JJ, heartbreak this week.
Yeah, losing Coach Deckard, it's a battle that he had been fighting for a long time, to be honest. Something that he knew was coming. He knew that this was something that was unavoidable. I don't think anybody expected it to happen when it did, though. And to lose Coach Deckard, you can see all the coaches for all the teams today honoring Coach Deckard, his legacy, the energy, the grit that his players brought for him on a day-to-day basis might be unmatched in South Dakota. What he meant to that Brandon Valley community and that basketball program was pretty special. But he impacted people in a lot of different ways as well, as a gym teacher, as an educator, and I think there's a lot of people here who are sad that that man is no longer a part of us and a part of this community, but we press on, and as a community in this basketball world in South Dakota, we're honoring him the best way that I think anybody knows how right now. And I think there's a community of coaches right now that are kind of rallying together to try to make sure that they bring the kind of energy that Coach Decker did during his career. And we'll talk a lot more about that as this tournament goes on. Back to action, obviously, here right now as we focus on this one, but that is definitely in the back of our minds here this weekend.
This game honors toughness. That's what those shirts say. There's a shot put up by Baskin. That's good.
These two teams looking to get the offense figured out here in quarter number three. 21-14 was our halftime score. Washington gets on the board first. Here back to action. We've got two full quarters of basketball left here in our AA quarterfinal matchups. Two games to be played tonight. We've already had one completed with Mitchell, the number one seed, advancing. The winner of this one will battle them tomorrow night in the semifinals.
Ismail, he played his sophomore year at Jefferson and transferred back to Roosevelt.
Boy, he is just relentless as he tries to find his way inside, getting bailed out here and at the shot clock. Just as it expires, that one goes, and a chance at a three-point play. An energy-boosting effort there from Logan Nielsen as he goes to the line.
That's a big, big basket there by Roosevelt. That foul is going on Hoffman. That's his third. That's only a third different player that scored today for Roosevelt.
Washington gonna have to fight through this zone defense now as Roosevelt makes some adjustments here at the halftime break on that end of the floor, and a foul on the way up will send us to the free throw line again. Jace Woods has been to the line already today. He's 2 of 4 at the stripe and heading right back there again.
Woods has played a great game defensively so far for Roosevelt. Only 2 points, but his impact out there much bigger than that.
They're gonna take a look at this one to make sure they get the call on the right defender this time. They went over to our alternate ref just to clarify things.
Should have been on Akeem Moko.
Yeah, I think they're going to double check to find out perhaps who this one's on. So the two teams may be going to their huddles. Chad DeYoung, Andy Diner, Jeff Hainfler out there along with our alternate Luke Langner on the sideline today. Looks like they got everything figured out. Free throw on the way up and in.
67% on the season for Jace Woods. This young man, just a sophomore. And looks like they're going to pull Hoffman from the game, which is a pretty wise move with 3 fouls. And that brings on Lubab Kambalo. He's a senior at 5'7", wearing number 1 for Washington.
Hoffman did not want to come out of the game. He's still trying to maybe petition his way back in with the assistant coaches on that bench for Washington. They want to keep him available for the fourth quarter. There's still a lot of basketball to be played in this one. Three on the way, no. Offensive rebound, though. Here's Ishmael. He'll launch a three. That's no good.
Well, they are flying to the basketball. Again, another open look for Roosevelt that doesn't go in.
We've had a lot of them today. 34 shots from the field, more than double what Washington has put up today. They being Washington, have tried just 15 shots. That one got stolen away. Nice little Euro step on his way in. And a nifty finger roll finish for Hayden Goff. What a transition bucket there for Roosevelt.
That's what the Rough Riders needed. Now they need some stops on defense. Oh, they're going to commit a foul there.
No contact on the way up that time. Crossing over, and then Logan Nielsen got tangled with the ball handler.
And that's his second foul. Well, Hoffman didn't stay on the bench very long. He's going to be back out there. And we're going to get Memphis Bylander into the game. His first appearance, number 12, a sophomore at 6'3". Roosevelt has a deep team. They will go to their bench. They'll bring 5 guys off their bench throughout the course of an average game. All right, that was quick for Hoffman. He just took it right to the hole and got the foul.
Hoffman, such an aggressive player. You can see it in the way he handles things, both offensively and defensively. The three fouls, maybe a product of his aggression on the defensive side, but he is relentless trying to get to the hoop. Works hard. That was his first shot inside today, though. He had taken six shots from deep.
Garang got that foul for Roosevelt. That was his first. And just like that, Hoffman checks back out.
Roosevelt hanging in this game, an eight-point contest with under six to go in this third quarter.
Benjamin Sprecher, 34 in now for Washington.
Washington has already matched their point total in this quarter from what they produced in quarter number two. A nice little bit of footwork again from Hayden Goff. We've seen him elevate his game in the third quarter. That's helped bring this Roosevelt team back within six.
Yep, and they're going to have to find a few more guys just to get some confidence, because, you know, misses are contagious, kind of like yawns. You know, one person starts missing it certain enough, everybody starts clanking it.
I think there were a few people starting to feel the yawns at the end of the first half of this one, but they're waking up now. This has been like a shot of adrenaline for everybody, especially the play of that young man. Hayden Goff has taken this game into his own hands. A steal there. Now the nifty no-look pass. Uh-oh, look at him. Here comes Roosevelt.
And the Roosevelt bench starting to stand and applaud their team. Coach Begeman's got his team fired up.
This is the closest we've had this game since the opening 2 minutes of action. Now a hold away from the basketball. They're going to get Ishmael with the personal. That'll get us to our media timeout. Taking a look at the no-look dish there. Hayden Goff and the Roosevelt Rough Riders are storming back into this one. We will be back in Sioux Falls with more AA boys basketball right after the break.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
In Sioux Falls, you see the Roosevelt fans. They're having fun. They're cool. They're collected. Just a four-point game with 4:49 left to go. Steve, at one point, this was a 20-9 basketball game. This Roosevelt team has come storming back, though. It's now 27-23. They've held Washington to just 7 points while they've gone on this little 14-7 run, getting themselves back in the game because of great defense like that.
You bet. That's Jackson Brower. Oh, he shot it.
Look at Jace Woods go sky high on that one.
Denied.
It has been impressive defensive play in the first two games of our AA tournament. Right here, you can see the elevation.
That's big time block there. But that young man is just a sophomore.
He's not on the track and field team. Get him into the high jump program. Traveling to call here. Teams continue to sub in and out. Hoffman back into the action now for Washington.
Remember a young man from Parker a few years ago. He was blocking shots. And talk about track and field. He was down competing at USD and competing in the Nationals.
You can find athletes all over the place in basketball. Gotta stay healthy during the winter. Get yourself tuned up. Basketball is a great way to run. Get that athletic ability on showcase. Who knows where it'll take you? These guys have been probably facing each other for quite a long time. Two Sioux Falls programs that know each other well. Seems like they found some rhythm on the offensive side, that being Roosevelt, but this Washington team, they're not going to go away without a fight.
Well, that was mishandled by Moko. It was a good interior pass.
good play design. Just Moco just couldn't quite handle that pass. I think Zach Anderson, if I remember, yep, the young gentleman from Parker a few years ago, had a standout track and field career down at USD, where they have a top-notch track and field program.
Traditionally, coaches will tell you that they want multi-sport athletes, in particular guys that move on to play in college, whatever sport they choose to play. Get your chance to get out there, try as many sports as you can, find what you like, find what you're good at. If you're a good athlete, you can do just about anything on the basketball court.
Yeah, Hayden Goff going to get tagged for the foul there. Tough interior play as Woods went over him, got him on the hand. Some subs at the scorer's table for both teams.
Washington has had a couple stretches today, Steve, of 3 minutes or more without points, without buckets from the field. Free throws kept them in this game, though, and kept them in the driver's seat. They have a 6-point lead, actually a 7-point lead now, because of their free throw shooting, where they are 12 of 15 today.
And there's another one, and they are perfect 6 of 6 in this quarter, are the Warriors. And that's how they're kind of keeping Roosevelt at arm's length here, as, you know, their shots, you know, for Washington, some of their shots have not been falling as of late.
See if Roosevelt can keep the offense chugging. An extra step here, I believe. No, they're going to say a foul.
Yep, that was Bylander trying to make the move, and I think Sprecher got him. That's only the first foul on Benjamin Sprecher. He is a freshman.
I say, I like the flow from Memphis Bylander. He kind of looks like Highlander. Remember the old TV show, yeah, movie, the long hair? And if you're going to carry that long hair, you got to be named Memphis, of course. Why not? Good look out there. He's trying to help his team get back into this game with 3 minutes left to go. This guy's been terrific, though, today. Ishmael getting tangled up right now. The double team, they're going to call a jump ball.
That possession arrow is going to favor, I believe, Roosevelt.
Nasser Ishmael today, 11 points, 3 rebounds, 20 minutes of action. He's been out there almost the entire way for his team today.
I was just about to say, I don't think he's taken a trip to the bench once for Roosevelt. And in a situation like this, you just wonder if those legs may start tiring out in the fourth quarter. On the flip side, these teams haven't played any varsity basketball in a couple of weeks. It's been a while since the SODAC 16.
It is a tough break to take as Ishmael again got tangled up near the free throw line, got fouled. Was it in the act of shooting, though? It doesn't look like they're going to say it was. Still inbounded from the baseline. Back in the game, Isaiah Garang, the junior, will give Memphis Bylander a little bit of a break.
Jace Woods, second foul on him.
Ishmael trying to find a little room inside. Dribbled it off his foot, though, and now commits the harm as he tried to make up for it. Tough foul there.
Yep, and that's going to be his third, and that's a tough break for Roosevelt. They're trying to set up a little screen on the left side there. Maybe a little pick and roll action, but just kind of fell apart there. Tough defense by Roosevelt. And that's 5 team fouls on the Rough Riders.
Goes in for Washington. Baskin lays it home. Ishmael will take a quick breather on the sideline. May not see him again until the fourth quarter with 2:40 left to go. You want to keep him available. With those three personals, you now lose the top scorer from Roosevelt.
And a man who literally put the team on his back this entire contest. We'll see how long of a break he has for the Rough Riders.
And 10 different Roosevelt players have gotten onto the floor today. It's his first bucket. He was 0 for 4 before knocking that one in.
Yeah, he's a 39% shooter from beyond the arc, and that is Roosevelt's game. They want to launch those three-pointers. They just have not been falling today. Tough screen there at the top of the key.
Still a 3-possession lead for Washington. They will try to extend it. Now a timeout called by the Warriors. So 2:09 left to go, Steve, here in this third quarter. Maybe feeling that pressure a little bit with Roosevelt starting to clamp down. Washington, smart timeout right here to try to just cool the Jets a little bit and get back into their offensive half court.
Yeah, I mean, you just want to set up a play where you can try to get something in the paint if you're Washington. I mean, they've knocked down a few three-pointers. They're 2 of 8, but where they've done their damage is most mostly the mid-range in the paint, and maybe try to draw another foul on Roosevelt. And you don't mind dropping to the free throw line if you're Washington right now. They are 15 of 18 from the floor at the free throw line. Turnovers 12 for Washington, 8 for Roosevelt so far, and the rebounding is pretty much even. 20 to 19 advantage, Warriors.
Washington is almost 50% from the field today. They're at 47% for the game, but they've taken 22 fewer shots than their opponent in this contest. That is maybe the most mind-boggling stat of the day, and 11 fewer threes than the Roosevelt Rough Riders have. They'll try one here. That's no good. And a one-and-done opportunity is that's brought back in by Goff. He has been great in this second half. They need more of his offensive abilities, though. Just 2 of 8 today from the field. He's been doing a good job of finding his teammates.
Washington has a lot of tall, lanky players that are good at guarding the perimeter. But that time, Brower just got a half a step beyond the defender's reach. And that's all the space he needed. And look out, here come the Rough Riders.
Brower has hit two straight. The Rough Riders have hit 5 of their last 6 shots from the field, and currently on a 6-0 run over the last minute of action. Washington, on the other hand, 2.5 minutes without a bucket, and that won't go. They'll go back to the free throw line. The scoreless drought from the field will continue. They continue to pile them on at the free throw line.
Tayden Nave got the foul, and that was a great play along the baseline as Jace Woods was roaming there, looking for his opportunity. He was set up well, and that pass just, or that shot just rolled off the rim.
This young man has been making a lot of noise at the free throw line today. That's his 7th make at the stripe in 9 tries. His 10th of the day coming up right here. That's good.
Yeah, this young man, really explosive, quick first step, and we've seen his leaping ability already.
2-possession game with 1:10 left to go in this third quarter. Nice dish inside, and again, we've been talking about it. But the eyes, the court vision from Aiden Goff as he finds his teammate Tayden Nave. Nave, the senior, 6'3", putting that one in. It's a big bucket there. 4 points, the difference between these two Sioux Falls schools. 3 from the corner, rattles in and out. Goff, another rebound. That's his 3rd board. 4 points, 4 assists, 3 rebounds today in 22 minutes. Looking for a layup here.
He cleared out a teammate. Got a little bit of a screen. Washington defense, I think, kind of fell asleep there. And don't look now, it's a 2-point game.
It was 21-14 at halftime. The Rough Riders have dropped in 19 points in this 3rd quarter alone. They've hit their last 4 shots.
And they're doing this run with Ismail on the bench, getting some rest.
Washington has not hit a bucket from the field in 4 minutes, and it will go a little bit longer. Goff, off to the races, puts on the brakes, threw it up. No, they'll say he didn't get it off in time. What a quarter from the 4 seed, the Roosevelt Rough Riders, who are back within 2. We go to quarter number 4, and back with more in Sioux Falls after the break.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Back at it here in Sioux Falls, the AA Boys State Basketball Tournament continues to heat up as we go into quarter number 4. 8 minutes back on the big board, and Steve, that was an electric electric third quarter offensively for this Rough Riders team.
They outscore Washington 19-14, and their shooting percentage is now up to 31%. Roosevelt 13-42, Washington 8-19 from the floor.
Ball taken away again, the defensive pursuit this team has brought in the second half. Mitch Begeman's got to be proud of the turnaround his team has put back forth on the floor.
Yeah, Tate and Nave with the big defensive play, and now you got Ishmael back on the floor.
That three no good would have sent this Roosevelt crowd into a frenzy as they looked for their first lead of the day. Instead, they get back to work defensively. Hoffman brought it into the front court. Now he wants to reset near half court.
Yeah, for Washington, you know, just got to be solid, kind of collect, catch your breath, and just go back to basics, execute on offense.
Looking for something inside, under 10 on the shot clock. That got tipped out of bounds. Last touched underneath that time by Jackson Brower, the 6'4 senior forward. This is a very senior-laden group here for the Roosevelt Rough Riders. A lot of guys playing in their final state tournament here this weekend. This one off the mark, off the front side of the iron. Goff is there again with another rebound. He has been just relentless on the glass today.
Yeah, pretty much all in the second half. That's four rebounds for him now.
7 minutes to go. Ishmael had that one ripped out of his hands for a moment. Now triple team, tried to put it up. That one got ripped away again. Tried to recover, but it ends up being Hoffman who comes away with it. Hoffman skip pass back outside. Now Woods looking for some help.
Man to man for Roosevelt.
Johnson crossing over, now handing it off. Everybody's touched it now as Verhey picks up his dribble. Back to Hoffman on the right side.
Trying to get a screen out there.
That one hangs on the rim, no good. Roosevelt with another rebound on the defensive glass. Looking at the rebounds today, they've been pretty even, but Roosevelt has taken control of that now, 23-21 overall.
Half the shots put up today by Roosevelt have been three-pointers.
Garang on the attack, inside. Got the defender in the air, but threw it up too strong. It goes out of bounds, off of Woods' fingertips. The officials, I believe, said it's going to be Washington basketball. They'll talk it over here, and they will overturn it.
Yep, that's a good job by the officials to confer there, because there was two Washington players that knocked it away from each other there.
Good decision there by this officiating crew. These guys have earned the right to be at the state tournament along with these players, these coaches. These are some of the best the state of South Dakota has to offer. That
Ooh, almost
for a moment.
A turnover there. Yeah. Gotta be, have eyes in the back of your head.
Ishmael, a little hesitation that time. Now down to five on the shot clock. Crosses him over again, nearly lost the dribble. Puts it up. No, that one missed everything. Washington with the ball.
Yep, they'll play on because it ended up in Washington's hands.
2-point game, 5.5 to play. Roosevelt back to work defensively again. They have been electric on this end of the floor since the halftime break. A renewed effort defensively. Hoffman, no, again on the three. Washington cannot buy a bucket here in the fourth. Neither team, in fact, has scored over the first 3 minutes in this fourth quarter, and there's going to be a timeout. Coach Begeman wants to talk things over with 5:12 left to go in quarter number four.
And that's a good timeout by Coach Begeman here. You know, let's settle things down. We've been a little out of sorts on the offensive end. We've got the timeouts to spend. Why not do so? As they, I believe, will still have three timeouts left. And of course, we'll have the officials timeout coming in a little bit, so it's a chance to get some extra rest out there for some of those players for Roosevelt. And they got to find something that works. Now, Brower's hit a couple of threes. Goff, he has started to come alive here in the second half. But you got to find that extra person, because Ishmael, yet to score in the second half at 11 points at the break. Let's see what he can cook up here. Is the Ishmael 4 of 14 from the floor, 1 of 6 from beyond the arc. He has 3 rebounds, but here's something that may be troubling. No assists. However, Hayden Goff, 4 assists on the afternoon for Roosevelt. Meanwhile, for Washington, 8 assists for Lucas Johnson. On, or check that, 8 rebounds, 2 assists for Johnson in the afternoon. In addition to his 8 points.
He's Steve Toom. I'm J.J. Hardigan. They're having fun in the stands. We're having fun here courtside with this fourth quarter matchup. It's our 4-5 quarterfinal basketball game here this afternoon. Washington, the 4 seed, has been in the driver's seat. Check that, the 5 seed has been in the driver's seat really the whole way. This one for the lead, no. Roosevelt, who is the higher seeded team in this matchup, has trailed really from start to finish. They are back within 2. Both teams remain scoreless here in quarter number 4. That'll change right there.
Yep, that was Verhey that made a great pass, and Johnson got the finish.
Back to a 4-point Washington lead now, 4.5 to go. Ball at the top of the key, there's Ishmael, he'll handle things. Wang looked inside for a moment. That's one thing that really hasn't been there today for Roosevelt, the inside game.
That's because they've been taking pretty much all threes, and there's a turnover.
Hoffman had it ripped out of his hands on his way up. They weren't going to give him the free transition bucket, but he will go to the line for a pair of free throws.
See who that foul is going to be on. Looks like they're going to give it to Goff. They will, and that'll be his third. Timeout on the court.
He will step aside from Sioux Falls. 4:15 left to go. Back with the conclusion of this game when we come back.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. Fans love it around here. This is one of those things in Sioux Falls. It's kind of just took on when the song came out. It's never stopped. The fans always get into it. As we get back into action here inside the AA Boys State Basketball Tournament. One game has gone final already. We saw in that matchup, Steve, the 8 seed Jefferson kind of battle back and give the number 1 seed Mitchell Colonels all they could handle. The Colonels weathered that storm. Now you got to wonder if Washington can maybe weather this comeback attempt from Roosevelt, or if the Rough Riders might be able to overcome a huge obstacle. It was 21-9 at one point. This Roosevelt team has just came right back, and they're within 5 late in this contest. That 3, no. Rebound from Woods. Boy, he went up high to get that one.
Yeah, Jamari Tiger now 0-7 from three-point land. Again, he's a guy that shoots over 40% from beyond the arc. Three-pointers are his specialty, and they just haven't been there today. Nice little give and go. Oh, that was Baskin who got the finish.
Baskin is one of the few guys who hasn't really gotten involved offensively today. He did early on. He's got a very quiet 9 points in this game, but just 2 of 4 from the field before that one. This one from Ishmael floats on home. He's been quiet since the halftime break, but now up to 13 points on the day.
Yeah, it's his first points of the second half, and that was one of the few open looks he had, as he managed to get it in the paint with that mid-range J.
Hoffman looking for some separation. Boy, he drew that foul and might have sold it to the officials. He knew his shot wasn't going to go. I have to give him the Academy Award here as you take a look. There was some contact, but hit the hardwood there to get himself to the free throw line. Any way, anyhow you can. Hoffman gets that one to go.
Yeah, for Goff, that's his 4th personal foul. He's going to have to check out of the game. And Brower's checking out for Roosevelt. They'll bring in Garang and Moko. 13 and 20, respectively, for the Rough Riders.
Washington back up by 7.
The largest lead since the opening moments of this second half. And Roosevelt made it a one possession game not long ago. It's ballooned back to a three possession lead. That no good. The threes are just not falling again. When they were starting to get gain ground, Steve, they were getting inside, getting some layups, getting to the free throw line, and it's starting to slip away from them a little bit.
Yeah, Brower had a couple of threes, and again, that last one, it's an open look, just not falling. And it looks like Ismail is going to get tagged for the foul, trying to guard the larger Baskin down low. And for Ismail, that's his fourth personal foul.
Coach Begeman,
he's got to go to the bench.
Going to go to the bench. He's going to bring in some size. Jackson Brower, a very physical player who can shoot the three. They're going to need that physicality and his ability to step outside here the rest of the way.
Now for Washington, do you slow it down? Because you got the fresh shot clock to work with.
Under 2.5 minutes to go. This is a make or break possession in this basketball game. Hoffman going out.
He's fearless.
Had to split through a couple defenders, use that jump step. Found a way to get it to go.
He's just an old school throwback player. Is that three is going to go in for Goff, and a quick timeout called by Roosevelt. But Hoffman's one of those guys, like I said, a throwback player, just, you know, a guy who can score, a guy who can make plays, hustles, got that lanky frame. I mean, just a, like I said, a throwback basketball player, and he's a good one too. Averages almost 14 points a game.
So this will be a 30-second timeout with 2:05 left to go. The officials taking a look at everything here with the way this one's played out today. You got to think the fouls will maybe become a concern here at some point. Roosevelt with two players sitting on four personal fouls right now, that being Ishmael and Goff. Two huge players in this game. They've scored 22 of their team's 38 points today.
SDPB recorded the state high school gymnastics competition last month. You watch highlights featuring the top individual performances from each apparatus as SDPB presents high school gymnastics championships. That's Sunday at noon, or at 1 Central Noon Mountain, SDPB 1.
Foul called. No, a timeout called. I thought they were going to get a whistle on the Roosevelt defenders, but the Washington coaching staff wants to take a 30-second timeout of their own.
Yeah, they got timeout suspended. They still have three left. Team foul situation, 3 on Roosevelt, 0 on Washington. Remember, you get the 5 team fouls, it's the double bonus. And if we go into overtime, that stays. It resets at every quarter. It does not reset if we go into overtime.
Taking a look at the numbers here today, 16. Check that, actually double checking. 14 turnovers today for Washington. 5 of those have come here in the second half. The pursuit of the basketball from this Roosevelt defense has increased significantly in the second half. They got close to getting a turnover on that last possession. Washington with 28 still on the shot clock will try to take good care of the ball here now with under 2 minutes to go and see if they can't put this one away.
Backdoor Hoffman.
Such a sweet pass. Hoffman with that burst of speed. Such a smooth basketball play.
And they just rotated it around to the other side, and the back door was just wide open.
Goff going in quickly. That one, no. Boy, and if you're watching back home, if you're a young basketball player watching Goff, the way he protected the basketball on the way to the rim. A lot of times you'll see players try to dribble their way through traffic there. He got a good power dribble, took 2 hard steps and went up. But he had both hands on the ball the whole way, ensuring that no defender would take it away from him. Got himself a trip to the free throw line. That's a big one there. Makes it a 7-point game. Now to make it a 2-possession contest with 1:34 left to go.
10 points for Goff, make it 11, all in the second half of play. He has stepped up his game. And again, Roosevelt, they've got to get some defensive stops. They can't let a whole lot of time burn off the clock.
Washington breaks the full court pressure, now trying to move it around out around the perimeter and take some time off. If they can take this clock all the way down on the shot clock, it would leave us at less than a minute in action remaining. Roosevelt's hoping for a turnover. They don't need a foul, though. And they'll get one right there.
That's Memphis Bylander with the push foul. That was the last foul Roosevelt had to give. It's free throws from here on out for the Warriors. And now, if you're Washington, you can just take some air out of the ball, but they're not going to. Oh, they go right inside to Chase Woods. What a play on the inbounds. They were aggressive.
Woods has been such a clutch player today. They haven't talked nearly enough about his abilities. Woods, 10 points. He's only taken one shot from the field. He's 8 of 10 at the free throw line, 8 rebounds today, and now a foul here after the turnover. Washington, after their struggles in the third quarter, Steve, offensively going nearly 3.5 minutes without a bucket. They've now hit 4 of their last 4 shots. They have found their rhythm offensively at the right time. They continue to get back to the free throw line. This will be 25 and 26 free throw attempts today for Washington.
Yep, and that's Lucas Johnson, who's 5 of 5, and Washington can pretty much put this one away at the charity stripe, as Roosevelt's just going to have to commit some fouls.
Coach Begeman's team can still get back in this with the three-point shooting. That has been a struggle today, 5 of 26 from distance, but they're going to need one very soon. Bylander kicks it outside, Garang the extra dribble. Back inside to Bylander, the layup is good. Coach Begeman takes the timeout. He wants a 30-second timeout. No, they're going to say his only option is a full, so that's what he'll get. 39 seconds left to go. Shot clock can't quite be turned off yet, Steve, but this is where, if Roosevelt wants to get back in the game, they're going to need a big defensive stop. The fouls are inevitable, but you can't have Ishmael or Goff commit the foul because they've got 4. So really, it's going to have to be somebody else to step up quickly and try to make a play for these Rough Riders.
Yeah, you've got to get that steal. Once that ball gets over the half-court stripe, if you're Roosevelt, then you're going to have to commit the foul. But you've got to make a play on the inbounds play. A big hill to climb for Roosevelt, as Washington has outscored Roosevelt 15-9 here in this fourth quarter of play. Shooting stats, 16 of 52 for Roosevelt, 31%, or 5 of 26 from beyond the arc. That's well below their season average, because Roosevelt as a team shoots 41% from beyond the arc. Today, 19, less than half.
Just has not gone their way as they thought it would, and that's left them in a bit of a bind here late in this one. Bring in the defensive pursuit now, and they nearly got the turnover. They're going to get Bylander, although Goff was in the area there, and that could have been his fifth, but Bylander commits the foul. To the other end we go.
Yep, that was a good foul there because time was ticking away, and Washington had the floor space pretty well, and they put it in the hands of Hoffman, 74% on the season.
He hits both of them. This game is over. Missed the first. It leaves the door ajar right now. Still a very difficult task. You need essentially 9 points and 33 seconds to win it. If he makes this free throw here, you would need 9 points and 33 seconds to tie it. Means a couple of free throws. He misses them both. Roosevelt's got to hurry, though. Ishmael into the front court. Being pursued, and now Hoffman from behind with the foul.
That's his fourth. That doesn't hurt Washington, so they had a couple fouls yet to give even after this one. So might as well, you know, if you can get a chance at a steal, you know, doesn't hurt you to commit those fouls.
They still have 2 fouls left to give before they get into the bonus situation. 3 outside for Goff. That one rattles home, and a timeout again by Coach Begeman. The 3-point counts. It'll be a full timeout, I believe.
Yes,
it
will.
It will be. 21 and 7-tenths of a second left in a 5-point game. Three-pointer comes at the right time. They still need at least one more 3 and a little bit of help. They want to get back into this one, but Washington will have the basketball and the chance to put this game away.
Again, you got to make something happen on the inbounds play. If you're Roosevelt defensively, you got to get a steal. You got to force a turnover. If that ball gets across half court or near half court, then you got to commit the foul. You can't let too much time tick off the clock if you're Roosevelt, if you can't get that turnover. And you got to hope that they miss their free throws. That was unusual for Hoffman. He missed his last 2. He's 74% on the season. Obviously, Washington's going to put the ball into his hands. Probably also that of Jace Woods and Samuel Baskin. They're their top free throw shooters.
20 seconds to go and a jump ball. No, they're going to call a foul. It'll be on Bylander. To the other end of the floor we go with this long walk. Again, you hit Two free throws, this game is done. Hit one, you miss them both. Roosevelt's back in this one, so these are a couple big free throws as the Warriors try to advance to the semifinals tomorrow night. You see Coach Begeman looking on. First one's in, the second one. Either the cherry on top, a good afternoon for Washington, or it'll leave Roosevelt with one last chance to get back in this game. This one up and in. Great free throws there.
Johnson 8 of 8 at the free throw line today.
Ishmael going in all the way. That one no good. And he hit the ground hard. Might be injured as he tries to get back up. Washington fans, they smell victory with 6 seconds to go, and they will just run this one out. They're going to check on Ishmael to make sure he's all right.
Yep,
he's
some of the bleeding. Washington players are coming over to tend to him. It's going to be a Washington win, and let's hope that Nasser Ishmael is okay. He hit the deck pretty hard after that last layup attempt. 52-45, that's your final score. It's Washington moving on.
Both teams will shake hands as this one wraps up. Roosevelt had a nice second half comeback in them today, but ultimately the fourth quarter belonged to Washington as they outscore Roosevelt 17-12 in our final quarter of play. The numbers on your scoreboard are correct. That's right, 52-45 the final. We will wrap this one up with some highlights, some stats, and get you ready for our evening session. Still two more basketball games coming your way from the AA State Boys Basketball Tournament. We'll have more on that when we come back.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center, AA Boys State Basketball Tournament coverage here on SDPB. Our second quarterfinal matchup is in the books. 52-45, the number 5 seed Washington gets, I guess, what you could call an upset victory here today. They were in control throughout much of it, but Steve, these Roosevelt Rough Riders came storming back in our third quarter.
Yeah, Hayden Goff with a big second half, all 14 of his points in the second half. He also got some rebounds as well. Nice pass by Goff to set up Akeem Moko. That was his only bucket of the game. There's the big swat by Chase Woods, who was impressive defensively. Woods elevating, drawing the foul there. He had a wonderful game at the free throw line. Jackson Brower knocked down a couple of trays to keep it close for Roosevelt. There's a nice pass inside, and the finish by Nave. And again, Hayden Goff put the team on his back in the second half, but too much of that man, Thomas Hoffman, 17 points to lead the way. And a nice backdoor cut there as Roosevelt, or Washington, rather aggressive in that second half. Field goals just would not fall for Roosevelt. 6 of 27 from the floor. From the free throw line, look at there, big discrepancy. Washington, 24 of 30, 80%, very solid. Rebounding even, turnovers relatively even between the teams. But Roosevelt just couldn't get the three-pointers to fall. That's one of their strengths. And they're one of the better free throw or three-point shooting teams in the state, but tonight was not their night. 17 for Hoffman, 14 for Johnson, 10 for Woods to lead the way. Baskin with 9, the top scorers for Washington, 14 for Hayden. Ismail had 13, the only players in double figures for Roosevelt.
The final polls in South Dakota had Washington as the 4 seed, Roosevelt as the 5. They got flip-flopped when they came to the state tournament. Washington gets what you could call an upset here today with the 5 seed advancing. They now have to take on the number 1 seeded Mitchell Colonels tomorrow night. We'll take another timeout. We'll preview that bracket with 2 more games in the quarterfinal round coming your way in a little bit here from Sioux Falls. We step aside one last time and back with our final thoughts after the break.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great. Like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.